The only night race in Formula One has become the Monaco of the Asian region. Spectacular Singapore hosts round 14 of the championship as the series begins the final run of seven flyaway races to decide this year's title race. Hub of one of the original Asian tiger economies, Singapore lies just under 100 miles north of the equator, and tropical heat and humidity just add to the challenge of driving this 3-mile, 5-kilometre street circuit around the Marina Bay. It's bumpy, it's twisty, it's hard on the brakes, it's hard on fuel consumption as well. And David, it's extremely demanding on the drivers for a race that lasts around the maximum duration for a Grand Prix, around the 2-hour mark.
Well, it does indeed. We've got a 100% safety car record here, and that pushes it towards that 2-hour mark. And we just consider for a moment a small racing driver's body composition made up of about 40 litres or so of fluid, and he might lose anything from 2 to 4 litres during a Grand Prix. So he's in a severe state of dehydration towards the end of this Grand Prix. Core temperature, we've mentioned before, rises up to 40 degrees. We know that as fact because a few of the drivers swallow a small temperature thermometer and they're able to get that data out sometime later. So they really are showing their athletic ability. It's very difficult sometimes to explain to people why sitting on your backside driving a racing car can be physically challenging, but imagine getting on an exercise bike in a sauna whilst dressed in your ski gear, and I think that might put your mind in that place.
Fernando Alonso leads the championship coming into this event. He's got 179 points. He's had 3 victories so far this year, but he starts 5th on the grid. Got a bit of work to do today. Just ahead of him, 4th on the grid, Jenson Button. He's had the 2 wins, of course, most recently in Belgium. He's had 4 podiums in total. But he'll be a little annoyed to be that bit behind his teammate in qualifying. Sebastian Vettel, though, didn't quite deliver in that final part of Q3, but it is his first top 3 start in some 3 races. Just the 1 victory so far for him this year. The memorial to Sid Watkins on the front of the Williams. That is Pastor Maldonado. The Venezuelan starts from 2nd place on the grid. He hasn't scored any points in 8 Grand Prix, but he did have that masterful victory in Spain earlier on this year. Can he get that sort of form back and get a podium finish for the Williams team? But of course, starting on pole position, it is Lewis Hamilton. His 5th pole position of the year. His 2nd pole position here in Singapore. He seems to absolutely love the circuit. It was a brilliant lap, as you showed us, David. He's had some 6 podium finishes. He is now 2nd in the championship. He's on 142 points. There's no doubt that he looks to be Fernando Alonso's closest challenger, and he will be chasing down a victory here in Singapore to narrow that gap on the Ferrari and take it into those final 6 events. Here's the grid and total detail then. It is Lewis Hamilton that lines up on pole position. Alongside him is Pastor Maldonado. Then you've got the reigning world champion Sebastian Vettel with Jenson Button starting from 4th place. He finished 2nd to Vettel last year. Alonso and Di Resta are next. And watch out for Di Resta, had a great result here last season. Mark Webber and Romain Grosjean are together on the 4th row of the grid. Then we have Michael Schumacher and Nico Rosberg. They use on tyres. Hülkenberg and Raikkonen in the Lotus are right behind. Felipe Massa only 13th on the grid in the other Ferrari. Perez, who starred in Monza, but he's only 14th on the grid here. Ricciardo and Verne, the 2 Toro Rossos, are next. Followed by the other Sauber of Kobayashi. Then Petrov in the Caterham. Kovalainen, who knows there could be a threat from Timo Glock here today from in the Marussia. Charles Peake is next up in the other Marussia. Bruno Senna further down than he would have been. He had a penalty for a gearbox change. Kartikeyan and Pedro de la Rosa complete the grid in their HRTs. The tyre blankets are coming off. All of the top 8 runners will be on the red super soft tyre. They have to run the tyre they qualified on. But 9th and 10th on the grid, the 2 Mercedes cars of Schumacher and Rosberg, we're just waiting to see what tyres they're going to be starting the race on, because they have the option. They didn't do a lap in qualifying. They simply went out, did a sort of installation lap, came back in again. So we'll just have a quick look to see if Mercedes are doing anything differently as we get ready to see them off on the final formation lap here. And now they've gone for the super soft tyres by the looks of things. Hülkenberg, we think, could well be on the soft tyre, which is actually the harder of the 2 compounds here this weekend.
Well, that's interesting. Let's just wait and see if we get confirmation when we see the Mercedes car come forward. We did try and eke it out of Ross Brawn as they go away in their formation lap. And as we saw in the build-up show, this is arguably one of the most important laps. Clearly, the last one crossing the line is the most important. But why would Mercedes have dipped out of qualifying and then chose to start on that super soft, except of course for the fact that it allows them a fresh set of tyres for the start.
Just looking at them through, yes, they're definitely on the red tyre, but Hülkenberg on the yellow, the harder of the two compounds. The cars are all away from the grid. You get that scurry as the mechanics all rush away from the grid with all the bits and pieces, spare wheels, etc., and the cars head around. Let's get a quick word from our man who's down in that scramble somewhere. That's Gary Anderson. Gary, clearly Mercedes are not doing quite what we expected. They've gone for the same as those around them.
Yeah, they've gone for the same. They've gone for the super softs, but they can use a new set. They had some sets left over, so you know they're on a three-lap newer tyre as such, and that's when the super soft really has that extra grip. So they're going to use that and try and jump a few places on the first couple of laps. But I would think I would have gone with two different strategies for them, one on super softs and one on softs, because that way they're gaining information for each other.
We're looking down the list. There are some others who've gone for the harder of the two compounds. Perez, Verne, Kobayashi, Glock and Pekin at the back, De La Rosa. So there are some split strategies, I should say. Gary, just how many stops really are we looking at here for this race?
Well, the fastest solution is two stops, but it's about rear tyre thermal degradation, you know, and that really is the rear tyres overheating. So very few people know how and why that happens. So I think you're going to probably see three stops for most people, but there may be somebody just trying to eke it out into that too. I think three stops is the safest.
Well, just picking up on what Gary was saying there, the Mercedes car is clearly going for the same strategy in terms of tyres, but we are hearing on the pit radio that Michael has a softer, or more loose is the correct expression, actually, more loose diff setting, and he's getting an information from his engineer saying that once the rear tyres go away, he can start to tighten up, lock that diff, and bring the rear axle as one, a bit like you would have in a go-kart, of course, which is a fixed axle.
So the cars just making their way around this long lap, and Lewis Hamilton making sure not to rush away too far, so they do stay stacked together reasonably well. Red Bull Racing failed to score any points last time out in Monza, with both cars failing to be running at the end of it. So McLaren got a chance to close that gap up in the Constructors' Championship, but there are other battles to watch out for, particularly between the likes of Williams and Force India. Force India currently seventh in the Constructors' Championship, 9 points ahead of Williams. Williams have got a car on the front row, but then Force India have got Di Resta starting in sixth and Hülkenberg possibly able to score points as well, whereas Senna, for the other Williams, is way down at the back.
Well, I think what's so exciting about this season, we've got seven different manufacturers represented in that top ten, and smiles all round from Williams. Susie Wolf on the right, the wife of Toto Wolf, as the cars do their final preparations and line up in the grid. Charlie Whiting keeping a watchful eye for the marshal at the back of the grid to signal they're ready to go.
So Lewis Hamilton getting ready for the start here in Singapore. He's won it from pole position in the past, in 2009, but he's been involved in incidents here as well. He tangled with Mark Webber a couple of years ago. Last year, he tangled with Felipe Massa, if you remember, damaged the front wing, got a drive-through penalty for that as well. There is so much opportunity for incident, if you like, around this Singapore track. We're certainly expecting a safety car at some point, but will they all get through the first few corners safely and get a decent run initially? Here we go then. Lights out, away we go in Singapore. Lewis Hamilton makes a good start, and Pastor Maldonado going with him in second place, but there's bunching behind. Four cars abreast virtually. Michael Schumacher trying to come down the inside, but Vettel going into second. No, yes, I think Vettel has grabbed second place. Rosberg right around the outside of Mark Webber there. Grosjean on the inside. Somebody just touched the wall, I think.
And Mark Webber and Rosberg both missed a corner as we see Alonso getting up the inside of Paul Di Resta, but great start from Sebastian Vettel. We'll need to see a replay of whether Rosberg and Webber gained any advantage by missing turn two, and I believe that Button's up to third.
Yeah, he is. Button's up to third. Maldonado, being cautious, has dropped to fourth, and then it's Alonso in fifth, and there you've got Grosjean on the outside of Webber. Webber squeezing him out, and Grosjean having to go over the curb, and has he given the place up? Yes, he has. Remember, he's back from a one-race ban for a first-lap incident, and he's trying to stay out of trouble here.
And Rosberg's got in front of Michael Schumacher. Schumacher started in front of him on the grid, but on the dirty side, both on new super softs. So you see the run down into turn 10. There's some smoke ahead as someone locks up.
Hülkenberg we're riding with now in the second of the Force Indias on the grid. 11th place for Nico Hülkenberg as he chases after the Lotus there. Of course, Kimi Raikkonen started down in that part with him, so he looks as though he might just have nipped ahead. Button, though, up to third. Alonso up to fifth. Webber goes through. Then it's Grosjean, Rosberg. Schumacher, Raikkonen is chased by Hülkenberg with Perez right behind. Most of the front runners all seem to have got through.
Front wing.
Yeah, Petrov's Caterham with no front wing, so he seems to be the only victim of any damage on this opening lap.
The question is, where is that front wing? Is it in a place where the marshals can recover it, or is it going to cause any issues? Let's presume, as it's a long lap here, especially this first flying lap when they're heavy with fuel.
Ah, did he say he hit Vitaly? That would be awkward if the two Caterhams actually tangled across the line, though. Here comes Lewis Hamilton, already no doubt looking after his tyres, but he won't want to see Vettel behind him. Button in third, Maldonado, then Alonso, then De Resta, then it's Mark Webber, chased by Grosjean, then Rosberg, Schumacher, Raikkonen, Hülkenberg, Perez, then the Toro Rossos, and no doubt Petrov into pit lane. Yes, here Massa is right at the back. Yeah, Massa, something went wrong for Felipe Massa, and the other Ferrari is right down at the back of the field as Petrov has come into the pit. So, Hamilton leads. Vettel will love the fact that he's managed to get second place, and Massa's way, way back, so something must have happened to him. We'll try and look at that later on. Michael Schumacher chased by Kimi Raikkonen. There is Petrov.
Massa's into the pits, as you can see the Caterham team there repairing that front wing. Pretty slick stop, change the tyres, of course, get that option out of the way, or the super soft out of the way. And Massa, let's try and see if we can get a Gary to keep an eye on what the issue is there.
New set of soft tyres, so they've gone straight from the super soft to the soft, and they had a puncture.
Puncture on the rear, so there may have been some contact around the lap.
Yeah, very likely. Of course, he started down in 13th place, and there are some incidents under investigation. Turns 1 and 2 incidents on lap 1 are under investigation.
Well, that was, may have been more, but it certainly looked like Rosberg and Mark Webber were offline going through turn 2, and what the FIA will do, the stewards will see, did they gain an advantage by that? It tends to be the case that Charlie Whiting will just take the view that as long as there's not an obvious gain of advantage, that is a normal race start. Anything can happen, and better to have that than, of course, cars coming together.
So no safety car right at the beginning of this race. They've managed to, despite the odd little incident, they've got away with it. See how they bumped the curbs? Need to do that here in Singapore to get the good lap times. Grosjean through from Rosberg, Schumacher and Raikkonen. They're all still pretty close together. Rosberg's in ninth, Schumacher's still in tenth. That's where they qualified. Senna ahead of Kobayashi, so Senna, I think, has made a little bit of ground.
Well, a great start there from Paul de Ressa. Alonso actually got left bogged down, and that allowed Webber and Grosjean to run it out, and then it was four abreast into the first corner, so Webber and Rosberg didn't really have any option but to run wide, and then joins up again into turn three. Look at Alonso down on the third row there, bogs down, and that allows Webber, Grosjean, and Michael Schumacher was actually trying to go down the inside, and that allowed Rosberg to come round the outside. He almost touches with Webber. That's going to be a difficult call for the stewards. A number of cars missed turn two completely, on board with Maldonado. Got to say, that was a nice start. He was on the dirty side of the track. That typically would cost you some time, but in actual fact, look at that, right under the gearbox. But he runs wide, runs deep into turn one, and that allows Vettel to just nip through. And as I suspected, a very cautious Maldonado. You know, the Williams team this morning, as we go on board with Bruno Senna, starting further down the field, but hooks it up nicely, release the cars, no DRS, of course, available for the first couple of laps. And look at the advantage he gets by breaking around the outside. Great avoiding action there. He nearly got taken out by the Toro Rosso. So in that instance, there was nothing that Bruno could do. And then, unfortunately, by that, he ends up getting passed by the Virgins. And there you can see the front wing of the Caterham lying on the exit of turn three.
Yeah, and he backed off a bit to not gain any advantage as well. So he probably won't be penalised there, Senna, despite going off the track. It's all about whether you gain advantage by going off. If you don't gain any advantage, you won't be penalised. Fastest lap initially then for Lewis Hamilton. But at the moment, Sebastian Vettel is lighting up the timing screens with his sector times in second place.
Because we don't have telemetry, you need to read the numbers on the display 3. That number needs to be between 30 and 80.
So, talking about settings on the Lotus for Grosjean.
Well, no telemetry was the message. We remember that Ferrari suffered from that in the last race in Monza. They were getting no information fed back to the engineers. So it's down to the driver now, as if he didn't have enough to do with a car heavy with fuel, more than 150 kilos. At this stage of the race, they're more than 10 seconds slower than what they've qualified. And as they get set in for what will be a long, hard slog this evening, Grosjean's just got a bit more work to do.
Yeah, it is going to be a long race, going very close to the two-hour mark, even if we don't get a safety car. Sergio Perez, he's on the soft tyre, the harder of the two compounds, so that slightly differing strategy, certainly from the race leaders, from Perez, who stormed through so impressively in Monza and had other race engineers from a rival team scratching their heads as to how that Sauber looks after its tyres so well. But here it's a different story in Singapore, and all of the teams are worried. They don't quite know how those rear tyres are going to last. Gary, obviously we've got through those first few laps. They haven't had a safety car though to help them cool those tyres, have they?
No, that hasn't been the, you know, there's no advantage from that obviously in this part of the race, because if you could get the safety car for the first couple of laps, it lets the tyre temperatures front to rear settle. So it reduces the understeer and gives the car a better balance. But right now they're having to hammer it on from the beginning.
Michael Raikkonen behind point six has RFA, and we need to cool the car. Cool the car if you can.
Okay, cool the car. That's a strange one this far into the race. You think it would have cooled itself to the right level. But yeah, I mean, it's one of those sort of situations. Right now, the lap times are still getting better for everybody. Nothing's settled down just yet. So once we start to settle down, we'll know what the pit stop strategy is going to unfold like.
Yeah, that's right. We've got a little way to go before we know that. Another quick lap from Hamilton this time. 0.3 seconds faster than Sebastian Vettel. The gap 1-2 is 1.7 seconds. As the fans here in Singapore getting a great view, and is that Katy Perry who's going to be playing later on tonight?
Yeah, normally you need a special pass to be out on the pit wall, but of course, if you have superstar status and about, I don't know, 50 million followers on Twitter, you can get out there and get up close to the action.
Yeah, she's part of the musical entertainment here at Singapore this weekend. But what's providing the entertainment right now is Formula One, and Hamilton leads. He's got that 1.7 second lead over Vettel. Button is still in third place. Pastor Maldonado is in fourth. Alonso in fifth in the Ferrari. Then we've got Di Resta and Webber. As we look back from the Mercedes here of Michael Schumacher, looking back at Kimi Raikkonen. Hülkenberg is behind, and then we've got Perez, Ricciardo, Wern and Kovalainen. And remember, Petrov had to come into the pits for that front wing change. Massa is still running after that earlier puncture, but he is running last of all through that little tricky chicane. And how much curb he used there. Every lap, David, you have to judge it. The concentration here is so total.
It is indeed, and the concentration that will be dominating the drivers' minds is how hard do I push at this stage on these tyres. They obviously want to put pressure on the car in front, try and force a mistake. It just fills the mirrors of the car in front when you can just see the activity of the car behind.
Interesting fastest lap, because he went for the yellow wall tyre, the soft tyre, did Felipe Massa, and a new set. And a new set's obviously always beneficial, but a quick lap from Massa.
It is, but he's running in clean air, so he can see his track and cool his car properly. We've heard the message to Michael Schumacher that he has to try and cool his engine. That obviously started to build too much heat sitting on the grid, and any running too close to the car in front, it's just going to affect your brake temperatures. We're also heard on the in-car radio that we've got available to us here that Hülkenberg's been told his rear calipers are too hot, so he's got to try and run. And you can see there, running behind Raikkonen, he's trying to run in clear air.
We will need target lap around 16 more laps. Target lap around 16 more laps.
Now, of course, he switched to the other tyre, 16 more laps. So they're looking at doing, what, sort of like 18, 19 laps on that set of the soft tyre.
I might suggest that they're going to try and two-stop it this afternoon, having already completed one pit stop. And whilst I was talking over the beginning of that radio message, Hülkenberg was running out of the slipstream of the car in front of Raikkonen. Now, the upside of that is, of course, you get fresh air coming to your car. The downside is you pick up the rubber and debris that we see being thrown offline.
Just looking at the times, Gary, first sector from Lewis Hamilton, although he's been going quick up to now, suddenly we might just be seeing a sign that the tyres are beginning to go off. What do you think?
Yeah, that lap time, his last lap was 0.4 seconds slower than his best lap. So yes, I think now, as I was saying earlier, just let's see the lap time stabilise and then see who drops off the most. So I'll be keeping a close eye on that on the top 10, because obviously with Rosberg and Schumacher, they've started with new tyres, and as I said earlier, they've got sort of three lap newer tyres than the rest, so they should last that little bit longer, and that's where their advantage from that is going to come from. It's going to be into lap sort of 15 or 16.
On board with Mark Webber, and he's running in seventh place, and you've got to be patient at this early stage of the race.
And just confirmation that we saw on the screen there whilst Gary was talking, there'll be no further action after the various cars running wide at the first corner. I think that's sensible. There was a lot of avoiding incidents, and if the drivers had actually tried to stay within the apex of turn two, we would almost certainly have had a safety car by now.
That's right. So Hülkenberg and Perez on their soft tyre.
Mercedes are holding this group like we thought. They are an option, should not last too long.
And yeah, so they're saying basically the Mercedes will start slowing down. They're on the softer tyre, what they call the option, the super soft, but it only has a limited life on this Singapore street track, and it's measured in sort of less than double figures probably around this track. And these guys on the yellow, the harder of the two compounds, could be in good shape, but of course getting past is very difficult here. You need a huge advantage to actually be able to overtake.
Well, we know from talking with the various engineers, they expect that you have to be about 4 or 5 seconds a lap faster to be able to complete an overtake. Now there just isn't 4 or 5 seconds between the front and the back of the grid, except when someone hits the cliff in terms of tire performance. So you know, you've got contrasting strategies being played out here in terms of the Mercedes trying to eke out as much as they can, as is Raikkonen there on the super soft, and then you've got Hülkenberg and Perez behind on the softer tyre, the yellow wall tyre, who should be able to go significantly further. Kimi Raikkonen would join him on the exit of turn 10. That's where he ended his race last time he was here in the Ferrari. He'll be a lot more cautious. They've actually changed the exit of the turn 10 chicane by removing the kerb that caught him out a couple of years ago.
Yeah, he's certainly had a good return, hasn't he, to Formula One. Kimi Raikkonen coming into this race third in the championship. Qualifying didn't go quite according to plan, but he has completed every lap so far this year, and that's pretty good. Not gotten into any trouble, hasn't had any reliability problems either.
I think it's quite a remarkable comeback when you consider Kimi. He sort of breaks the mold in the way he goes about his racing. He's not one for really PR. He clearly is a fit man, but he does, or it certainly appears he does, just enough to get him through a Grand Prix. Funnily enough, I met a couple who were his neighbours in Switzerland.
You have by far the quickest pace. You have by far the quickest pace. So let's use it. Don't destroy the tyres immediately.
Bit of a confirmation of you're doing a good job, Felipe. All is not lost. It's just coming back to Kimi. Having met his neighbours in Switzerland, they say that his lifestyle was definitely James Hunt-esque, and I think that, well, as I said, he breaks the mold in many ways, but lying third in the Drivers' Championship, no one's won a World Championship without at least one victory, so if he's going to win this championship this year, he's got to be getting a victory sometime soon.
Yeah, never scored any points here in Singapore in the past, though, so he's going to try and correct that. He's down in 11th at the moment, just outside the points, of course, so currently, Michael Schumacher has the last points playing place, and Mark Webber's just gone quick in the first sector. He's sitting in seventh place, but he's just established a new quickest first sector. Interesting that the leaders haven't really dropped off their pace. They're fairly consistent, but Webber may be looking after his tyres well.
We're getting into that area, Ben, where any time over the next few laps is the point at which the super softs could just run out of their operating window. It's not the actual degradation is not the wear. There's enough rubber there, but it's this thermal degradation that we've spoken about on the Pirelli tire, and it's something that comes in. It could come in if you're lucky a couple of corners before the end of the lap. We see a replay here of Bruno Senna going down the inside of Heikki Kovalainen, and that seemed like a bit of a misunderstanding. Heikki looked like he left the door open expecting Bruno to be on his inside earlier, and then Bruno pulled back in and then thought, oh, he is leaving the door open. No harm done, but would have cost them both a bit of time.
Yes, that's right. Senna's had a tough weekend, but gets through there. That puts him up into 16th place as you see the leaders go through. Hamilton chased by Vettel. There's the gap back to Jenson Button. He's 6 seconds behind Hamilton. And we are going to see some pit lane action then. And presumably
it's going to be Webber.
Mark Webber, yeah. Yep. It's Webber who is in. Now, this is quite an early stop. They're going for it. Wonder if they're going to go for plan a three-stop with Mark Webber and look at tyre wear and see how that information helps Sebastian Vettel. Could possibly be that way. Away he goes then on the harder of the two compound tyres. And he hadn't really lost a lot of performance. Gary, I'd like to get your opinion on that, because Webber at that point still seems to be going quite quickly.
Yes, he did. I mean, I really don't understand that stop, because, you know, it's late in the race, you're going to have the problems with the tyres. A couple of laps now just makes such a difference way down the line. It's at lap 58 or 59. So, you know, his last lap time was his best lap. So why bring him in now? Why not wait till they just do drop off that tenth of a second? You know, these teams have three section times per lap. It means you get 180 sort of spots of data. It's not just 60 every one every lap. So they've got a lot more information to make decisions on.
Well, he's getting past Charles Pick easily, as you would expect.
Yeah, he had DRS available there. And we're hearing, as you see, a replay of presumably someone having a bit of an incident into, looked like a car spinning through. Indeed, into the wall goes one of the Marussias. And I expect to see that car coming into the pits. Yeah. Difficult time. And then we see Sebastian Vettel missing the chicane, which he'll get away with it a couple of times as long as you don't gain lap time. So down under braking, decides against turning in. Clearly would have felt the rear end moving as he went to turn in, didn't want to risk it. Now, we've also heard, whilst Gary was talking to us there, that Lewis Hamilton's been told he's in the window. So any time he wants, then that's clear that the McLaren team are ready to service his car. And strategy, I think, is interesting around here this afternoon, because you can only use the previous information that says you will get a safety car this afternoon. So maybe they're not thinking of this as a 61 lap race. They're thinking of it as a, well, an average safety car around here has been at least four laps.
Okay, try not to use first gear. There is a problem with first gear, so try not to use it.
That's not going to help. And that's surprising in a way, because they actually put a new gearbox on that car after he slapped the wall yesterday, but clearly they're having problems with it. You can see, by the way, already, David, a lot of rubber beginning to build up offline. That can cause problems, not only if you run over it, but if those little bits of rubber get trapped in the slot gaps in the front wings. And that has happened to teams this year, hasn't it?
It's something that we're used to seeing the Ferrari mechanics get a little metal ruler and just run it through the slot gaps in the front wing. We should look out for that, Ben, with the other teams during the pit stops. Quite incredible to think that they're able to do so many things during a under 3 second stop. And just as we look at Sebastian Vettel there chasing down Lewis Hamilton, we go on board with Bruno Senna, and Mark Webber's dropped down to 19th place after that stop, currently 43 seconds behind the leaders. Well, pit stop time, total time in the pits, of course, about 28 seconds.
Senna just tucked in behind Daniel Ricciardo here. Jean-Éric Vergne is further ahead. The Williams, obviously, with greater pace than the Toro Rosso, but this is what we were talking about. You can have greater pace, but you need a lot more to be able to overtake here, as just heading round there still is Sebastian Vettel, but the McLaren of Button very much closer behind him. And yeah, getting ready for a pit stop now.
Looks
for
like Vettel's in.
Sebastian Vettel, the soft tyre, the harder of the two compound tyres, going to go on the car here. And that rear grip suddenly went away from him. We saw him have to miss the chicane. He really struggled on that last lap. The tyres gave up, and he is into the pits for a tyre change. And McLaren seem to be in better shape, looking after their tyres here in Singapore, than Red Bull do. And Vettel now on his way again.
Well, what's absolutely crucial now is, where does he drop in amongst the pack? And if he jumps into some clean air, then he'll be able to run a very fast outlap. And if you look at this bunch of cars in front of him, that's exactly where Lewis Hamilton will come out, in amongst that group. So, you know, this is not just a straight race of car against car. This is having to get through the traffic.
Gary, what have you got for us?
That last lap with Hamilton was 1.8 seconds slower than his fastest lap. Now, as David just said, you know, he's trying to get himself up through the traffic, but at the moment, he's really running the risk of losing quite a lot of time to the guys around him. Jenson Button is actually only, half a second slower than his fastest lap. So, you know, Jenson's running very well here and picking it back up again. So I expect Jenson to come out of this on top.
Look at Sebastian Vettel trying to fight his way through the traffic. He's behind Sergio Perez. Perez moves out wide, and Vettel takes the place now. Will Hamilton come in at the end of this lap? That's what we might expect. He's still got about a third of the lap to complete before we see whether he comes in. Vettel gets through though now on those yellow-walled soft tyres, but it is the harder of the two compounds.
Well, crucially, if Jenson Button has got the tyres to do another lap at least, this will give him, as Gary's just said, the opportunity to jump Sebastian Vettel, who's losing time in amongst this traffic.
And Button has definitely closed up to Hamilton a bit on this last lap. We'll check that next time around. He was 4.5 seconds behind as they went past the start-finish last time around. But let's see now whether Hamilton is going to head into the pits. I don't think he is. He's going to stay out there for at least another lap or so as we watch this little gaggle of cars. Ferrari definitely getting ready though, and that means presumably that Alonso will be coming in. This, yes, it is the championship leader, Fernando Alonso, from fifth position. The Ferrari comes into the pits, and of course he wants to try and avoid losing too many points here today to the likes of Hamilton and Vettel. It's the yellow walled harder of the two compound tyres that goes on board the Ferrari, and Mercedes also getting ready.
Michael Schumacher in, so Mercedes managing to go a reasonable distance on those super soft, as Gary said, brand new tyres. So Alonso is going to rejoin into some clean air here.
Yeah, and that'll certainly help him. Jenson Button, meanwhile, did gain about a second on Hamilton.
Lost 0.3 in sector one, similar sector two.
My tyres, I have a funny feeling.
He has a funny feeling.
Well, let's hope that funny feeling is that tonight's going to be a good night, because he's in a good position right now.
That was a funny spark, wasn't it? But yes, Button definitely still faster than Hamilton on that last lap once again. The big question now, Vettel's got to try and cut through this traffic if he can. And he's got himself up behind Kimi Raikkonen. So he's got past Hülkenberg, and now he's trying to get past the Lotus of Kimi Raikkonen. Remember, all the guys around him, their tyres are going off. And so they're struggling with a lack of grip, and he's trying to make the most of it here.
Yeah, well, he's going to struggle to stay in front of Button, as we see.
Lewis is going to be coming in. We've just heard that McLaren getting ready for Hamilton to be coming in. I guess Button will stay out there. He won't be coming in on the same lap, obviously.
Now, once again, Button making good use of these tyres, seemingly able to, with his smooth driving style, eke out a little bit more performance. It's interesting to see the contrasting styles of the McLaren drivers. Lewis seems like the man more often than not able to get the maximum out of it. As you see, Lewis Hamilton has pitted. Let's see if McLaren could beat their previous best pit stop, which is incredibly, what, 2.4 seconds?
That's right, yeah. They got an award for it. That was really good once again. A very fast pit stop by the McLaren crew. Paul Di Resta coming in behind, by the way, as well. And also, was that Nico Rosberg?
Nico Rosberg, yeah.
Yeah, coming in. 2.9, so a very good stop. Not their fastest of all, but that certainly does them well. Where does he come back out then?
Ahead of Raikkonen,
and he's ahead of Vettel. So that's crucial.
Well, he didn't lose as much as I expected, actually. When you look where Vettel was just before he stopped, but the crucial thing will be, where will Button come out? And Vettel will get the pass on Raikkonen, surely, on this lap as he go through turn five onto the back straight. He'll have DRS.
Such a crucial opportunity this for Sebastian Vettel. He needs to make this move to avoid Hamilton running away. He does it, no problem at all. The DRS, the flap on the rear wing, reducing the drag and giving him those extra kilometres an hour he needed to get past Kimi Raikkonen. And Kimi just staying out of trouble, trying to go a bit deeper into the race, because the people that have stopped already, they might be able to do it on two stops. They're more likely to have to do three stops. Let's just take a look at the pass.
Just straightforward through the kink at six. Kimi doesn't even try and put up a fight. Run down the inside would have put a lot of dirt in his tyres. But just looking at the times, Maldonado is actually closing the gap to Jenson Button. He was only 2.7 seconds behind Button on that last lap. So have we reached the point where Button might end up being under pressure from Maldonado? And looking at the middle sector again as we track Maldonado and Button, it looks like Maldonado's still a little bit quicker again. So we've got a great battle here between the Williams, the McLaren, and the Red Bull. And of course, Lewis Hamilton leading the way.
Battle for 10th between Paul Di Resta in the Force India and Mark Webber. They've both been into the pits, so that's dropped them down the order. But these things will settle down once everybody's come in. Maldonado's in. Pastor Maldonado from the second place here. Button is still out there, and Button's still doing a good job. He got a personal best in the middle sector, so his tyres are definitely lasting better than we sort of expected. Maldonado in on lap 14. He ought to be able to do this on a two-stop race there, Maldonado, if he can keep it all together. And now where's he going to rejoin, David?
Well, it looks like he'll come out just in front of, well, behind Hülkenberg, but just in front of the battle with Perez there and the Ferrari, and then Raikkonen's in. Yeah. Vettel had lost his lost a little bit of time behind him, and then Raikkonen comes in. Let's just keep an eye. We'll see some more activity. Will Button be able to get another lap out of this?
So the Lotus, not quite as quick, the Lotus team, 3.4 seconds, not quite as fast as McLaren. The target for all these guys is always to try and get below 3 seconds. And we hear that Jenson Button will be coming in at the end of the lap. Fastest lap now for Sebastian Vettel. But Hamilton and Vettel are both putting in quick laps on their new tyres, having made the switch. And Gary, let's. What are you thinking at this stage?
Well, obviously, you know, for Jenson Button, he is a little bit slower, 2/10 off his fastest lap. And Vettel, with the new tyres, has just done his fastest lap just about a second faster. So it's one of those sort of situations. I think Jensen's looking at the long game. Those last 5 to 10 laps of the race is going to be the important ones. At the minute, he's done 5 laps longer than Sebastian Vettel did on this first set of tyres. So that's going to put him in a good stead at the end of it.
Right, so we'll keep watching that.
The race is still good enough that we could still stay out for a bit.
Massa's down in 23rd place after picking up a puncture on the first lap of this race. And Button is in. Jenson Button then from what was the lead. He'd stayed out there a bit longer. Fernando Alonso, meanwhile, is trying to get past Sergio Perez as Maldonado trying to get past the Force India ahead of him. Now, can McLaren turn Button around as quickly? That wasn't as fast. So not quite. There seemed a bit of a delay dropping the car back down again. Not as quick as Hamilton stopped. Where will this bring him out? Will he be in front of Hamilton? 3.8 seconds. He lost over a second on that stop.
Hamilton, Button have gone have crossed the start finish, so he's come out behind that group. So he hasn't made as much progress as I expected. It seems he just dropped off in performance towards the end of that run. So that slots him back out in third place and behind this battle here. We've got Hülkenberg and has got in front of Maldonado.
No, he's still in front. He hasn't been in, remember. Hülkenberg started on the yellow-walled soft tyre, and he has stayed out. Like Perez here, Perez hasn't been in. He's in the Sauber, chased by Fernando Alonso. Both of them trying pretty hard. Oh. Maldonado getting sideways as he tries to get round the outside of Hülkenberg.
Well, did he make the corner at turn 7? He was... Well, he manages to keep the position, but the amount of carbon dust coming off that front axle of the Williams as he went very deep into the corner. And I can only imagine as he went through the kink at 6, the car bottomed out, and that was why it had that sudden kink sideways. Of course, the DRS open, it sheds around 100 kilos of load off the rear axle, so massive feeling of forward balance. That makes the feeling of the driver, it's as if the steering gets heavier. It's like the rear is just being lifted up and taking away that feeling of grip and security, but he made the pass stick.
So Perez still fending off Alonso. He's still on tyres that he started the race, like Hülkenberg just up ahead. Here comes Alonso then, and there's no chance for Perez to defend any further. Alonso's got more grip available and gets past the Sauber, returning the favour for a couple of weeks ago at Monza, where Perez grabbed that second place towards the end. Now, this is what Maldonado did, David.
Yeah, you see, he just spins up the rear tyres at probably around 160, 170 miles an hour with that DRS open. So that is actually one of the downsides of DRS if you have it in a kink like that, and I'm sure that'll be part of the discussion in the Grand Prix Drivers Association. And there's some of the corners, oh. And look at how close it was down with Nico Rosberg and Kobayashi. That's down into turn 7, and great catch from Kobayashi.
Yeah, it was.
And this is a replay of Fernando Alonso and Perez. He'll just have saved up his cares, releases it on the run out. That's Ferrari engine against Ferrari engine. And anyone who would like to think that Perez has been signed already to Ferrari, well, if he has, he wasn't thinking about his future team. He's got his eye firmly on this afternoon, which is what we want.
Bravissimo, bravissimo.
and he got a congratulations from his race engineer. But after the first pit stops, Lewis Hamilton still leads. It's Vettel in second, the gap between them, much as it was actually before the first pit stops. 1.5 seconds is the gap between the McLaren and the Red Bull, then Button third and Maldonado fourth.
But crucially, Vettel, even though he's been out a little bit longer on these tyres, has taken about being a bit tense out of Lewis Hamilton on this last, this first sector of this lap. So it's looking like Vettel feeling a bit more comfortable now. He's burned some fuel off and will burn about 2.2, 2.3 kilos of fuel per lap around here. 10 kilos will cost you just under 0.4 of a second. So these cars becoming more responsive, easier for the drivers to make the tyres last, and just a bit more forgiving in the braking zones, a bit less mass when you ride onto the kerbs. They're still fairly lumbering in comparison to where they would have last driven these cars in qualifying. You know, around a 55-second lap at the moment in comparison to qualifying, where pole position was a 46 for Lewis Hamilton.
Yeah, that's right. So 9 seconds away from qualifying pace. And you can see the behaviour of the cars, just that little bit more sluggish. You're riding with Alonso now, who has caught Nico Hülkenberg. Again, Hülkenberg hasn't yet stopped in this race. He's trying to go deep into the race on his first set of the harder of the two compounds of tyre. And he's doing a good job so far, Hülkenberg. He was very disappointed after qualifying yesterday. Felt the team hadn't really helped him get out at the right time, the right place. But he's responding with a solid drive so far. But of course, he's giving up a lot of grip to the car behind, Alonso, on much fresher tyres.
And when he eventually does pit, of course, he'll let's just round it up for ease. It'll take him about 30 seconds down the grid. His teammate De Resta has pitted already. He's run around in eighth. And Hülkenberg, when he eventually does pit, will probably come out in around the 15th. So mark as Fernando Alonso stays on the racing line, and Hülkenberg doesn't put up much resistance as he's been running about a second a lap slower than Alonso.
Yes, and in fact, De Resta's not far behind Hülkenberg, even though De Resta's made a pit stop. So just shows you the different strategies that will be playing out between the two Force Indias. De Resta still in with a good chance of scoring good points here today, qualified well. And the two that are sort of slightly out of the rhythm of the others are both Hülkenberg and Perez, not being into the pits. There is Lewis Hamilton then, maintaining the gap. It's 1.3 seconds over Sebastian Vettel, then a further 3.7 seconds back to Jenson Button. Maldonado is fourth. Hülkenberg currently fifth, but due a pit stop. Alonso is sixth. Perez is seventh. Then it's De Resta, Weber, Rosberg. Grosjean is in 11th place. Michael Schumacher currently in 12th. Kimi Räikkönen 13th. And Senna has worked his way up to 14th. Then we've got Ricardo Kovalainen. Charles Peak has just made a pit stop. Then we've got Massa, De La Rosa, Kobayashi, Kartikeyan, Petrov and Glock.
Well, we're on different tyres now for both Hamilton and Vettel than the ones he started. It looks like McLaren was more comfortable on the super soft, but on this soft prime tyre, it looks like Vettel has got a bit more pace and piling the pressure on also slowly onto Lewis Hamilton.
Now, De Resta is ahead of Perez, so he's managed to gain that place. Perez, remember, on tyres that have done now 18 laps, crosses the line, chased by Mark Webber. That is for eighth place currently. Oh, and a big slide on the back end. You can see the rear tyres just didn't have the grip there for Perez.
Well, in a difficult situation right there. And another difficult situation brewing is Hülkenberg is running a couple of seconds slower than Paul De Resta, who's just behind him. Mark Webber goes up the inside into turn five, and in the end Perez not able to do anything to defend against that. But the difficult situation that Force India have, Paul De Resta stopped already on fresher tyres, and to allow both those drivers to run a clean race and maximise their potential, they're going to have to ask Hülkenberg to not make it difficult for his teammate to get past. And that of course takes away the inter-team battle from those, as we see Perez locking up the outside right and then thinking against trying to get through the chicane at turn 10. Goes a long way around.
I guess that's where he gave up the place to De Resta, probably on the exit, because De Resta went through the chicane and he may well have given up the place, did he? No, certainly De Resta came past him fairly soon after that.
I think it's out of 13. De Resta gets a much better drive off 13, and Perez really struggling with the tyres at this stage. And it looks like the man that's able to, well, there's what I would have expected to happen, a mature decision there from Force India. And you've got to say, Hülkenberg, that's a sign of a true team player there. He's making a good job of going a long way on these tyres, but it's the only fair thing to release his teammate, maximise the team's opportunity to score points. Those who are new to Formula One, team orders are allowed.
So we're on lap 19 out of 61. We're coming up for one third distance. That's all. This is a long race, and the guys have to keep focused, keep concentrating. Remember the heat. Hülkenberg is in. So Hülkenberg's managed to get to lap 19 before making his pit stop. Certainly he can do it on two stops. But will this work for him in the latter stages? Perez is also in. Interesting how they've both gone exactly the same distance on their new soft tyre. And in comes Hülkenberg. Perez will slot in just in front in the Sauber pit, but there's no problem.
Well, they went a long way, but the lap times at the end, of course, were pretty slow. So I'm interested to know what Gary thinks that might give them this afternoon.
Yeah, Gary, based on the number of laps they did there, does that allow us to think ahead to what the leaders might be doing?
Well, I think if you look at it, if Vettel came in at lap 10, you know, I would say he's buying into doing a three-stop race without a problem. And Jenson Button came in lap 15, so he's looking at trying to eke that out to a two-stop race. These other two guys here, Hülkenberg and Perez, you know, they're looking at a two-stop, I would say. The one that's in the middle is Lewis Hamilton. He came in lap 13, so I think there'll be a few people down in McLaren flicking a coin as to which way it should go, because Vettel is pulling him in now. You know, not that much, but he is pulling him in, so they've got big decisions to make pretty soon.
Well, Ron Dennis famously tossed a coin over $1 million on either way on Ayrton Senna's contract back in those days, so they're certainly not against tossing the coin and making brave decisions.
That's right, but I'm sure they'll be studying lots of data as well before they make a decision on Lewis's car. But Hamilton and Vettel still very evenly matched. One thing to remember, though, is just watch Daniel Ricciardo, young Australian, doing a fine job at the moment in the Toro Rosso. He's down in 16th place, but keeping off the wall, that's the key thing. Being the car in front, David, we've seen, is always an advantage. It does allow you to manage your tyres a little more easily than the guy behind.
Well, you're running in clean air, and you've got the confidence of knowing on this circuit, as we said earlier, you need to be up to 4 seconds faster, presuming you don't get right into the DRS zone through turn five. So it's a huge amount of advantage to be the car in front, and if you can play strategic, know where to go fast to break the toe for the DRS and then save your tires in other places. A little bit like Monte Carlo, you can control the pace here much easier than on some other tracks where overtaking opportunities are a lot more open.
Lovely view down over that last corner, the Singapore flyer, the big wheel on the left-hand side, past the pit building, which is the only sort of permanent part of the circuit that was built especially for the track. The rest of it is all normal streets of Singapore, closed off for the weekend and providing the backdrop for another intriguing race here. Hamilton, a former winner on these streets, he loves the track, but he's being chased by the guy that won here last year, Sebastian Vettel, who put in a brilliant display. Into the pits has come the Ferrari of Felipe Massa. Meanwhile, Alonso, going quite well, was quicker on that last lap than most of the leaders around him, but he's got a nearly 5 second gap to make up on Maldonado. So Alonso's still in fifth place. We're on board here with Kimi Raikkonen, who sits 11th behind Michael Schumacher.
Well, he's Finnish. They're famous for liking their saunas, so just put yourselves in the mind of the driver right now. They've been out there for 20 odd minutes of racing, and can you imagine sitting in a sauna with all your clothes on for 20 minutes and knowing that you've got another hour and a half or so to go?
Going quickly though, Kimi, here at the moment. Good first sector, fastest of anybody in this race. The Lotus car is one that sometimes seems to come alive on a certain tyre. Sometimes it doesn't work on one of the compounds and then remarkably comes alive in the second part of the race. So we might see that once again. Raikkonen still though trying to chase down Michael Schumacher at this stage.
Well, number of purple sectors being done at this phase of the Grand Prix as people have made their pit stops, the fuel's burning off. We've got Kimi Raikkonen set the fastest sector. And the
okay, Michael, suggest diff magic for turn 18 to the end of the lap.
Well, thank you for Mercedes for coming up with some little expressions that then we can talk about. And I think we've had someone else talking about a magic paddle in the past. So when he says diff magic, let's presume that's the M setting for the diff. And so just to avoid any issues of misunderstanding, Just coming back to what I was saying before, Raikkonen's fastest in the first sector, Hülkenberg in the second. He's just on the fastest lap of the Grand Prix so far on a 154.4, which compares to Hamilton, who's on a 56.6. So 2 seconds faster than our race leader from Nico Hülkenberg.
Yeah, well, there's less fuel in his car, and he's on a newish tyre, I suppose. But it does show you that the tyres are going away fairly quickly. Schumacher, Raikkonen, neither of them have ever scored points here in Singapore before. Michael ran into the back of Sergio Perez here 12 months ago.
Interestingly, we've got Fernando Alonso on a 55 flat. That's 1.6 seconds quicker than Lewis Hamilton. So it does seem as if there has been either some traffic to have passed that we've not seen or some other issue out front, because the chasing pack are catching them.
Look at Senna's improvement in compared to these guys. And, you know, he's come from a long way back. He had the gearbox penalty, so he started 22nd on the grid. But it's showing genuine pace once again. We know Maldonado showed it in qualifying. Senna had a horrible time in qualifying, hitting the wall. But he's catching now the likes of Raikkonen and Schumacher and trying to get into the top 10. So good effort this from Bruno Senna. He's ahead of Jean-Éric Vergne. Hülkenberg is behind them as well, as he again is lapping very quickly. Ricciardo 15th. Perez is now in 16th place, having made that pit stop. Kovalainen is 17th, ahead of Kobayashi. And then Timo Glock, Charles Peak still running. Listen in here.
Copy yellow.
Well, that's got to be better than red. He's not telling him he's on the prime tyre, the soft tyre. That must be a grading system. So saying, look, guys, I'm getting to that point where I'm going to be on the radio screaming red, 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 and that'll be a pit stop coming up. And just on that last lap, Alonso, once again, a 55.1, which compares to Lewis Hamilton on a 56.1. So Alonso in fifth place, bringing that gap down to Hamilton to 11 seconds and closing at a second a lap. This looks like Alonso. We saw that amazing comeback from 10th in Monza to getting on the podium. Could he be on for something similar this afternoon?
Yeah, well, certainly going well at the moment is Fernando Alonso. He is down in fifth place, still watching the battle for 10th here between Michael Schumacher and Kimi Raikkonen, with Bruno Senna not that far behind, but sounds as though he might be struggling a little bit for grip at this stage. Perez is also going fast on his new tyres, but he's all the way down in 16th position. We are on lap 22, so as you say, just over the third distance mark. For those who might be three-stopping this race, well, we might see them starting to head into the pit lane over the next few laps, so we'll keep an eye on that for those that are definitely going to be doing three stops. Massa has gone fastest once again. He's very much out of sync, though, with everybody else.
Yeah, he's a long way off. It'll be a tall order for him to pick up a point or so this afternoon. And I wonder what's going on inside the helmet of Kimi Raikkonen, world champion, of course, one time, chasing Michael Schumacher, seven times world champion, and is known to be pretty handy racer, of course, as we see a replay here of a Caterham being driven out onto the debris there by the HRT. And we've got a problem for Hamilton.
Hamilton's in trouble.
He's lost drive.
Hamilton is out of the lead of the Singapore.
He's in neutral. Look at the dashboard. He's got a zero in the middle. He doesn't have a gear.
So another failure to finish for Hamilton by the looks of it.
Pulling the paddle and there's no gears getting selected.
His world championship hopes are disappearing rapidly with that. Lewis Hamilton shakes his head. He surely can't believe what's happening here. It's a non-finish for McLaren when they seem to have a certain amount of control here. I wouldn't say he was definitely going to win this race, but he was going to score good points. He was well ahead of Alonso, who was down in fifth. And this changes everything. And now Vettel leads the race with Button second, Maldonado third, and Alonso catching in fourth. Well, I can't believe it, really, David. We saw Jenson Button fail to finish last time out. We've seen Lewis. He was in that incident at Spa just a few races ago. And what has been a purple patch in terms of pace is not being converted into points.
Well, we haven't seen what led up to that, but looking at the car, everything looks intact on the outside. So a little bit of smoke coming out the back of the car. That's a pure mechanical failure. He has done everything right so far this weekend, delivered when it really mattered in the last part of qualifying. And look at the disappointment as he walks away.
I bet he goes back to his yellow crash helmet next time.
Well, shaking his head there. You've got to feel for Lewis Hamilton. who knows what would have happened later in the Grand Prix, but...
That is a disconsolate figure walking away. Lewis Hamilton, no points from Singapore. And that has... Let's just listen in here.
Shifted down the gears into turn one. There, I think it's gone, the clutch or something, and the drive is gone. You can see he's pulling the paddles, and he's got a box full of neutrals. The frustration there as he hits the steering wheel. And, well, he's listening.
We have a gearbox failure. I'm really sorry about that. Did everything we could yesterday. We'll just have to look forward to the next one. Great driving up until then.
Well, you hear that? We did everything we could yesterday. That tells us that that was a known issue within the McLaren team. You can see the smoke coming out of the back of his car as Sebastian Vettel comes around the corner. And I have to tell you that when you see your competitor have a problem, you know that's an opportunity for you. It has happened to Sebastian Vettel. It happened to him last week. It happened to Jenson Button, of course. So I suspect that we'll find out in retrospect that McLaren did have an issue after qualifying. And they've, of course, quite rightly tried to mask that and control that as best they could.
Unfamiliar voice talking to Lewis. For us, it was Mark Temple who's engineering Lewis this weekend. Andy Latham away on paternity leave, and Andy won't be happy watching this from home.
No, I thought you were going to tell me that it was... they were saying, you can tell them. You tell them. I'm not telling them.
Yeah, well, maybe it was part of that as well. But, for Lewis Hamilton, it's just not what he needed when he was in such good form. And this man now... Sebastian Vettel, as he comes up to lap Vitaly Petrov in the Caterham, has an advantage of 3 seconds over the other McLaren. There's Jenson Button, then he's in second. Maldonado and the Williams.
Locking up into turn one. A lot of brake dust coming out of that Williams. We have seen that at previous Grand Prix. But very high brake wear around this circuit, and Maldonado could be finding himself getting marginal on brake wear later in the race as he's being chased down here by Alonso. And long way to go in this Grand Prix yet. So as we commiserate the disappointment for Lewis Hamilton, all is not lost.
That's right, there's still a championship being fought over. Vettel, of course, only a point behind Hamilton, still trying to close the gap himself to Alonso. But Gary, the brake dust we were seeing from the Williams, which we've seen a couple of times, should we be concerned about that?
Well, I would have imagined they've got it under control. We have seen it here, we see it again, yes, at that left front. You know, that is brake wear. Whenever the brakes get too hot, get up to like 900 degrees, suddenly the discs start to wear. It has to go abort and go across the curb. But it's one of those things, you know, it's about changing the brake balance that little bit. So the team need to be on top of that, because they'll be monitoring the brake wear and the brake temperatures. So they need to be telling them now. You can't save it in the last five laps. You have to save it now.
Lewis Hamilton, what do you say? I mean, what do they say to him? What does he say to them?
Well, I got to say it, he looks incredibly composed in dealing with that disappointment, and that's the mark of maturity that comes as you go through your Grand Prix career. Racing drivers tend to deal with the disappointment and the reality of what's just happened very quickly, because quite simply, you know, you can't waste any energy on the past. You have to focus on the future. And he'll be keeping a close eye on his competitors now, and of course these drivers want to win fair and square out on the racetrack. But reliability is part of the team game in Formula One.
Alonso, meanwhile, desperately trying to make up some ground here. If he can get past the back marker, then he's going to try and close that gap to Maldonado. And he is going to get past Pedro de la Rosa. So no problem there. Fellow Spaniard, not causing any problems. And de la Rosa, despite being a very experienced campaigner, has never actually raced here in Singapore in the past. That year he did for Sauber a couple of years ago. He actually got replaced by Nick Heidfeld before they came to this event. Alonso, though, definitely closing up to Maldonado as we see the Williams team now getting ready for a stop. This is very much sort of three-stop territory here. And we're on lap 26, still a long way to go in this race. So unless we're going to say it's Senna in, yeah. So it is Senna. Maldonado may still be on a two-stop. Let's wait and see. But Senna into the pits has made good progress in this race. But let's see what he can do here and make sure the guys get a good, clean stop underway. Now, he's gone back out on the super soft tyre. Of course, he was way down at the back of the field, wasn't he, at the start of this race, and he started the race on the option, so yeah, on the super soft. So it's interesting that he's gone for the super soft again.
Well, clearly feeling that the super soft that he's putting on will be a used set. That means they've been through a heat cycle in qualifying. And sometimes when you put a brand new set of tires on, you get this sort of peak of performance and therefore build up in temperature. And then you see this sort of drop off after that, where when you put a heat cycle on your tires, then you can get a bit more consistency out of them. And there has been quite a big spread in lap time difference between the super soft and the soft tire, the option and the prime. And if you can just get the super soft to hang in there, and that will be the tire that allow you to explore the lap time and chase down whoever you're racing against. You see Alonso coming out from behind the Caterham just before the last turn. A lot of debris being thrown offline already. Little marbles coming off the tire. So you don't really want to have to run offline anywhere, because you pick up those marbles on your tire surface, and then you need to wait until you've got lateral load at the next corner before you can sort of take off that built-up rubber again, which of course takes away your contact patch to the tarmac and makes the car feel a bit like you're walking on ice.
So we're looking at the battle here between Daniel Ricciardo and Sergio Perez, and as the two of them head round there in 13th and 14th position, slightly out of sequence, remember, and keep an eye on the leaders, see if anybody might be deciding to come in and make a pit stop soon. So much debris, particularly through the last corner there. If you get offline there, you're just going to be straight in the wall.
Well, that's because it's the fastest corner on this track. It's the only place where you see high lateral load. The main issue here on tire wear and the thermal degradation as we go on board with the
This is Jean-Éric Vergne, I think.
That was a fairly straightforward pass on the Caterham. DRS wide open. Running out onto the marbles, I think, is what the director wanted us to see there. Maybe the sparking floor as they go across the crest of this street, of course, when it's not being used for Grand Prix racing. There's bus stops and cars parked and all the rest of it. So it's always a challenge for these places to have a surface which is acceptable for Grand Prix racing. These cars at 300 kilometers an hour, the plank, the wooden plank that's under the chassis is skimming across the track surface. All of that heat radiates into the carbon floor and into the seat of the driver. And it has been known for drivers to end up with blisters on their bottom from the heat buildup.
Oh, hopping over the curb once again, but that's very much standard territory. Lovely camera there.
Love that angle. Yeah. That's what you have to do in a street circuit. Hug the concrete barrier. And brave stuff there. The drivers can't see the outside of their tires. They can just see the top of them. And you would think, actually, we would practice before the season going through, you know, two cones or something to judge the width of your car, but we never do that.
We suggest you increase your pace, otherwise temperatures will drop out of the window and that will kill the tyres.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah, Rosberg currently running in seventh place at the moment.
So sort of polite way of saying, go faster.
Yeah, they're always trying to find different ways of saying the same thing. But let's just tell you what's happening here. Sebastian Vettel leads the race. He's got a 3.1 second advantage over Jenson Button. Maldonado is a further 2.3 seconds behind, sitting in third. And Alonso, who was sort of catching Maldonado for a while, the gap is a bit more constant now. Alonso's fourth. Paul Di Resta is in a solid fifth. That's a genuine fifth place. He qualified well. He sits fifth. Weber is in sixth place. Then Rosberg. Grosjean eighth. Michael Schumacher ninth. And Kimi Raikkonen currently rounds out the top 10. Behind them, we've got Hülkenberg, Ricciardo, then Perez. That's the battle you're looking at right now. Ricciardo and Perez. Then Vergne, Senna going quickly. Senna's just set fastest lap. Kobayashi, Kovalainen, Massa still running. As now, Perez getting very close.
Great on the brakes there, down into turn 7. And it's quite clear what his intention is. Gets a little bit wide with understeer through 8. And trying to hassle Ricciardo here. Show his car as wide as possible in these mirrors and try and force an error. Both on the same strategy at this point in the race.
Yes, that's right.
Banging over the kerbs there.
Now, it does look as though most of the leaders are hanging on to the amount of grip reasonably well, but Weber is going to be coming into the pits.
We are in the window, in the window.
Well, that just confirms again that that means that Jenson Button's in the pit window as well, so it's over to the driver. As soon as you feel that the tyres are about to drop off and hit the cliff, we're ready for you. Give us the call.
Gary, let's get some thoughts from you. Webber is now heading into the pit lane. Of course, they brought him in early anyway, didn't they, initially? So they have to now come in earlier than everyone else again.
Yeah, they're coming in now. Obviously, they came in the lap 9 before. So, you know, from here on in, it is definitely down to keeping your fingers crossed, but you can make it without another stop. But he's gone out in the super soft this time. So I don't think they'll make the rest of the laps. What is it, 32 laps to go? I don't think the super softs will make that for sure. So he is committing to another stop, trying to use the speed of these tyres to pick up some places. For me, if I was Jenson Button, he's 3/10 of a second on average faster than Sebastian Vettel. Don't bring him in just right yet. The window's open. Just be ready, but leave him out there. As long as he can go quicker than Vettel, it's going to do the last 5 laps of the race. It's going to count.
Right, so we'll watch for that. This was Webber in a moment ago. Oh,
ran wide on the way into the pit lane, got up on top of the kerb that's there, and then pulled it back across. That would have cost him a little bit of time. Of course, the drivers have to practice their pit in and pit out. That's all taken into consideration in the total time lost when you do a pit stop. So in the particular battle that he found himself in with Rosberg, then that might have cost him some time. It might have cost him a position, actually.
Raikkonen, meanwhile, still hasn't found a way past Michael Schumacher. These two old foes are still running around together. Schumacher in 9th place, Kimi Raikkonen in 10th place. All of them trying to go a little bit deeper into this race and then maybe just get through with one more stop. But as we saw with Webber, it looks like he's definitely going to have to come back in one more time. The red wall tyre won't be able to do 31, 32 laps, so he's going to be coming back in. But these yellow tyres. Into the pits comes 3rd and 4th place men now. So Maldonado and Alonso are both into the pits.
Battle of the pit stops here. This is for the mechanics' honour, who can service their car more quickly. And the Ferrari's out. What's going to happen with the Williams crew here? They seem to be struggling a little bit with that stop, but he does get released in front of Alonso. And it was a slower stop there for Williams.
Yeah, 4.2 versus 3.1, but he has kept him out in front, and they've both gone on to the yellow. Maldonado, sorry, on the red. So he's on the super soft, Gary. So it's likely, surely, that Maldonado is going to have to make another stop, whereas perhaps Alonso is going to try and do half a race. Can he really do that on this set of tyres?
Yeah, he's got a brand new set of the softs on. He was looking pretty good in that last stint that he did with the softs. So he went from lap 12 to lap 30. It's not as far by any means, but the car's a lot less fuel in it now, so, you know, they're a lot easier on the tyres. But for Maldonado, yeah, for sure, no way of 30 laps on those super softs. Well, I don't think so anyway.
So Williams perhaps playing a slightly more conservative game here, David. But it's crucial from their point of view to score points, particularly in their battle with Force India, and Di Resta's going well in this race too, so maybe that's what they're really thinking about.
Well, clearly Ferrari, in taking that decision, it makes it extremely unlikely that no matter how well hooked up that Ferrari is and how well Alonso drives it, that on the different tyre, this early stages, he'll be able to hassle Maldonado unless he makes a mistake. There's a tyre advantage, clearly, which will give Maldonado a better lap time. He's got a bit of traffic ahead of him here, though, as he runs in behind. That battle there, Grosjean following Rosberg. So this may actually play even further into Alonso's hands. This is not good for the Williams if they are experiencing some brake wear issues where they're overheating and starting to oxidate, and that's where you get all of that carbon dust. So this is the last thing they want, is to be running in the dirty air of those slower cars in front. So they'll be hoping that Grosjean and Rosberg will be coming in anytime soon, and then they can release some fresh air. It won't be cool air, but certainly some fresh air into those brake ducts.
Still some cars travelling on the east coast partway up above the track.
So, Mark, you might need to cut through some two-stopping traffic. That's Hülkenberg, Raikkonen and Schumacher ahead in a group.
And so that confirms, as we thought, that he's on 3 stops. Not going to be easy, but as we know, overtaking is difficult here. But you've got to make the most of those softer tyres. That's what Maldonado's got to do here. He's got to try and quickly get past Romain Grosjean and Nico Rosberg ahead. This is all helping Alonso.
It is, but what a tall order that will be for Mark Webber. That tells him that he's not only got to pass those guys, but he's got to get another 28, 29 seconds up the road to be able to cover the fact that he has another stop. Otherwise, he'll be behind those two stoppers.
Meanwhile, Sebastian Vettel still leads this race in the other Red Bull. Alonso tucked right in behind Maldonado there, isn't he? My goodness, almost having a go at getting past.
Never mind almost, he will have a go as they run out onto the back straight, down into turn 10. messy stuff here with an HRT. Will Alonso follow through? He does indeed. And right. Has he used up his cares in that first attempt, or has he got some left for the run out of turn 13, which is coming up as you go across the bridge, break down into 13, slowest corner on the track.
How easy, Dave, when you're in a group like this, particularly when there's a back marker, to just almost get caught out by the way it all slows up in front of you?
Well, the concertina effect, of course. The car in front makes his braking point, and as he starts shedding speed, the car behind reacts to that, and then again the car behind him, and you can be caught out a lot by how much earlier you're forced to have to brake. And put on top of that, the fact that you're getting turbulent air off the car in front, so the downforce that's available in your car is reduced. So when you do hit the brakes, it just doesn't slow down as much. You know, it's like taking weight off the car. Yeah. And this is certainly difficult for Alonso to be running in four cars worth of dirty air. Just put yourself inside an aircraft and going through the clouds or following another aircraft. Well, you know how that shakes the aircraft around. Well, the Grand Prix car doesn't shake around, but it just loses its downforce across its wings. So difficult situation here.
Up through the first few corners there, past all the hospitality areas up on the outside. Some great viewing down in those first couple of corners, but we've got quite a tussle between this group at the moment. Maldonado and Alonso.
Well, Maldonado got a great drive off of turn five, and although Alonso would have been in the DRS activation zone, it looked like he lost out a lot on the run through five and missed an opportunity there to potentially get in front of Maldonado. But you can see just how difficult, even with DRS, it is to overtake in this track. And through this tight section, they all bunch up. Alonso again as they go through turn nine, getting very close to Maldonado. On the run down to the chicane, Maldonado pulls to the left to pick up the slipstream from the car in front. Through the chicane. Oh, that hurts when your head bangs off the head restraint at the side. It's just not fun, but that's part of Formula One.
I know drivers still do complain about that chicane. I know you don't like it at all, and Vettel's been making some comments this weekend.
In a great position now. Can he have a go down the inside? Maldonado goes defensive, so will Alonso go around the outside? Cut back maybe as they run out of turn 14.
Not really any
chance. And he goes to the inside, and this will be close as he go in through turn 15. I was holding my breath there because I knew they would have to squeeze in that braking zone. And here they are through 17. Well, he won't be brave enough, surely, to go down the inside into 18. This is under the grandstands.
Great stuff between Pastor Maldonado and Fernando Alonso, though.
It's great stuff, but I've got one hand across my face because you just never know what's going to happen with these guys.
And Maldonado sliding around up towards the last turn they come, and just got himself a bit of breathing space once again as Alonso tries to close up. And what's really interesting is that the super soft tyres on Pastor Maldonado's car really not giving him the amount of grip that we thought he would have. Oh, and that's
the car
Tekeen.
Safety car will come out, I would suggest.
Now, Renkar Tekeen, the safety car, this is perfect for those guys.
Turn really 18.
Going for the two-stop race. Turn 18, that's beneath the grandstand. In comes Kimi Raikkonen. The team's trying to respond as quickly as possible to the safety car, which has been called for now. Raikkonen dived into the pits. That was a good call by Lotus. They got him in. Safety car is out, and we'll try and pick up Sebastian Vettel. Now, Vettel's a long way around. He'll actually pick up a part of the group. Gary, I think the pit lane's going to start to get quite busy, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, it's going to be busy. This is worth keeping an eye on. Everybody's out here now, so obviously they'll come in here as quickly as possible, get it done, get back out into line. Just Raikkonen might just have lost a place for doing what he's doing there, but I'm sure he'll pick it back up. I'm sure he'll pick it back up again.
Just seeing the accident, David.
Carthy Kane. Well, he turned into the corner, the rear started to slide, and as he corrected into it, of course, it just takes you on a wider line, and that's the unforgiving nature of a street circuit. And the marshals who've stood there patiently all weekend felt the need to unleash some fire extinguisher.
In comes the race leader, Sebastian Vettel. Remember, they have to keep to a certain speed. As soon as the safety car is called, they can't sprint in flat out, but Button is in as well.
This will
now
block him when he goes for his release, of course, and the Red Bull lollipop man, Daza, as he's known, had to wait before releasing the Red Bull, and still maintains the position, relatively, of the McLaren.
It cost him quite a bit of time. The pit stop was 5.1 because they waited for the McLaren. a slow pit lane speed limit on a street track, just 37.5 miles an hour before they can pick it back up again. But there isn't quite the same sprint there used to be under safety car conditions, because they do have this regulation that as soon as the safety car is called, you have to reduce your speed to a certain set level.
They have a lap delta displayed on their dashboard, which their dashboard is connected to FIA marshalling lights, which will tell them about blue flags, yellow flags, if there's a red flag, and of course when a safety car's out, and they have to drive to a set delta time, and that maintains the speed around the lap in a safe manner and neutralizes the race in some respects depending on where the cars are on the circuit.
Interestingly, Maldonado's been in there is now. Alonso has therefore passed to Maldonado. Alonso will be in third place. So what Williams did there was they put him out for a short stint on the super soft tire and now have reacted because of the pit stop. So they've sent him back out. They will hope that they can get to the end now with a bit of safety car on what he's on. This was the stop for Sebastian Vettel.
Well, it's just a replay of the fact that they had to wait. Car was serviced, but the rules are you cannot do an unsafe release. And then the McLaren car comes in, and here it is from Sebastian's point of view. Look at that, front's done, car's down, wait for the red light and the lollipop to move. And so close to the ankles of the McLaren man. These mechanics are so brave standing out there. I would not want to be the man closest to the pit wall for any amount of money.
Right, we can draw breath a little bit and just sort of work out what's going on, because the safety car now, of course, leading the cars around slowly as they gather up the remains of the HRT of Narenka Tekayan. Sebastian Vettel is the race leader. Jenson Button is in second place. Then we've got a lapped car in there. And of course, what we must remember is they will be allowed, the lapped cars will be asked to move round to join the back of the queue once everybody has gathered together. But Alonso has moved up to third place. He'd already made his pit stop, if you remember, before the safety car came out. So that has moved him ahead of Maldonado, who's made an extra stop. Let's just see.
Okay, Kimi, we do not need to save fuel. We do not need to save fuel.
The safety car certainly helping on fuel consumption. Fuel consumption a bit of a marginal here at Singapore. They go to the grid with the heaviest fuel tank of all, and they are now going to be able to relax a bit. So even behind safety car, a little lock-up, and that's because, presumably, David, Sebastian's doing his utmost to keep these tyres up to temperature.
Well, tyres, brakes, of course. You need to be ready for when that safety car comes in. If you don't keep heat in your brakes and it doesn't radiate from the disc into the inside of the wheel, then you lose ride height. And then when you go for the restart, as a lot of your suspension travel and a lot of your ride height control comes from the actual tire itself, you just have the car banging on the deck. So, interesting message there from the Lotus guys to Raikkonen, saying he didn't need to save fuel. So that means that he can rev the engine freely behind the safety car. You need to accelerate as much as you can and then decelerate to get heat in the brakes and then maintain tire temp. It's very difficult to generate much heat by weaving. It's psychologically a good thing for the driver, but it actually doesn't do much for the surface temperature.
Alonso up to third, as we mentioned. Di Resta is now running in fourth place, then Hülkenberg in fifth position. Now, Hülkenberg has only made one stop in this race, and he hasn't responded to safety car. He's on a slightly different strategy, Hülkenberg. So I'm not sure that we'll see him actually be there at the end of it. And of course, then we've got Mark Webber, who's now into sixth position. Perez is in seventh. Then Rosberg, Grosjean. Maldonado's dropped down to 10th place because of making that stop. But it's sort of counted against Maldonado, all this. The timing of the safety car, I think, has hurt Maldonado. Gary, just give us a little bit of a sort of update on strategy, because Hülkenberg will, I think, have to make another stop, won't he? He's only made one stop so far.
Well, he started the race on softs, went to softs in his first pit stop, so the team's probably thinking they just can't make the end of it.
We've got an hydraulic problem. We need to retire now.
Another retirement. Pastor Maldonado with a hydraulic problem. They say they have to retire it. And Williams, who's so desperate for these points, he's still running at the moment, but...
Well, he either has ignored the message or he's hoping that they'll change that message before he gets to the pit lane entry.
Yeah, it's running, isn't it? I mean, They said on the radio hydraulic problem, but obviously the gearbox all seems to be working okay. So it's a slightly strange one.
It is a slightly strange one, yeah. These cars are driven by hydraulics, throttle, gearbox, clutch, everything. So at the end of the day, it must be something they're seeing in the system. It's either losing fluid or something that's going to happen and stop it on the track. So they're bring it back to the garage rather than stopping it out there on the track and maybe causing another safety car.
You see the replay here. Carter Kane turns in full of commitment and then loses the rear, corrects into it and just runs out of road.
Yeah, so end of race for Carter Kane. This was De La Rosa, his teammate, into the pits. Now what happened here? Problem with the right rear coming off, but look at the amount of brake dust around, and certainly some pretty impressive images in the heat and the humidity here of Singapore as well. It is just, they're just dripping out there.
Well, if you remember, we had Mark Webber blow a brake disc in the run into turn one a few years ago, so it is hard on brake wear. This helps, of course, having a safety car. It reduces the energy, and you see that car passing on the left side. That's a number of cars. Cars 21, 22, and 25 are allowed to overtake and overtake the cars in front, pass the safety car, and come around. It's doubtful they'll be able to get round in time to get to the back of the field before the safety car's called in. But that is, I think, a fair system. You've just got to be careful that the cars following the safety car aren't weaving around when you decide to try and overtake them. But that message should have been and would have been passed on to the various drivers in front of those cars. You see Dickie Stamford there, the long-serving member of Williams, getting a message from Colin. Not quite sure exactly what Colin's official title is at Williams, but again, they've both been there since way back in the days when I was a test driver in the early 90s.
And everything at the moment still running from our point of view, from what we can hear and see at least, okay, but the team clearly very worried about what's going on Maldonado's car. He is 10th in the running at the moment.
Well, just looking at the aftermath of the incident at turn 18, mixture of sticky rubber and skid marks. That's not all down to Carter Kane. There's been a number of cars in the support races, and of course through free practice that have gone in there. There's always the accident black spots, whether it's out on your everyday roads or on the racetrack, and these are just the more difficult corners where if you do make a mistake, it just is no margin for error. And these cars, of course, evolve lap on lap, and the drivers do their best to judge as the fuel burns off exactly how much grip there will be. And sometimes you hit the brake and you think, well, that was a little bit too early. Other times you hit the brake and you think, I wish I was anywhere else right now than sitting in this car as it heads towards the barrier.
I think Narain had one of those, didn't he?
He did indeed.
Yeah, poor chap. But he hit one of the Tech Pro barriers. They're energy absorbing. They do stop the car bouncing back out, unlike some tyre barriers.
Wonderful barriers. If you know, the barriers of choice for drivers to hit. Much better than
the Armco.
And definitely much better than concrete, because there's no give at all in concrete.
That's right. Something like just under 1,700 of those Tech Pro barriers around this track. It takes them 3 weeks of assembling. It takes 3 weeks leading up to the Grand Prix just to get those things in place, but certainly important. Now, Maldonado has come in. We heard the radio conversation that indicated there's a problem with his car, and sure enough, Pastor Maldonado has come into pit lane. Meanwhile, the backmarker's trying to catch the queue. There's still some catching to do, so we're not going to get this race underway just yet. Let's watch and listen here. Well, there's not many clues, but you've got a feel for Pastor Maldonado. This weekend, David, he's done everything right, and yet he ends up with no points again for, I think it's the 9th Grand Prix in a row.
He hasn't scored a point since Barcelona. Obviously disappointed for the Williams team and for Pastor. Did a great job in qualifying, but actually, I've got to say, I'm pretty worried for the BBC's team access before the Grand Prix. He thought we were a good luck charm.
Yeah.
Was happy to talk to us just a few minutes before he jumped in the car. Well, it looks like that's been blown out of the water now.
Now, the leaders are all out there looking at the pit stop times. Hamilton has had the fastest, although that's turned to be fairly irrelevant. Just to remind you, if you joined us later on in this race, Lewis Hamilton seemed to have it pretty much under control. He wasn't dominating because Sebastian Vettel was always within shooting distance, but Lewis Hamilton did lead this race from pole position, and then all of a sudden he had a box full of neutrals. He had no gears at all that he could play with, and Lewis Hamilton is out of this Grand Prix and the loss of potentially 25 points as he tries to chase down Fernando Alonso. And you know what? Alonso started fifth, didn't have a brilliant qualifying session, He's looking at another podium finish here today. He sits in third place as Pastor Maldonado peels off the overalls, and the whole team just shrug, and there's just nothing they can do for him. He's pretty hot after racing for whatever half distance in this Grand Prix, but he is not going to get points for Williams today.
The more the safety car will take, the higher the likeliness that some people might try to go to the end.
Yep, and that's a very good point. Sergio Perez being told that effectively the more the safety car's out there, then everybody else may be able to go to the end of the race on what the tyres they're on right now.
Well, yes, I mean, I imagine everybody other than Webber. Webber might have a little question mark, he's on the super softs. But for Maldonado and Hülkenberg, they've got to stop again because they've only used the soft tyre, they haven't used the super soft tyre, so they're going to have to do it sometime. Now, I must admit, when Hülkenberg didn't come in with the safety car, I think I'd have taken a gamble on that, because letting these cars pass and catch you back up again, it takes two safety car laps for a Formula One car to catch you back up again. So that's what's going on right now. You know, it's a waste of racing laps, this procedure, but it does mean at the start of this race, whenever it restarts, all the quick cars are going to be together.
Yeah, which is good. I mean, that's part of the new rule, but it is taking a while. I mean, I'm just looking at our driver tracker, and De La Rosa still got nearly a third of a lap before he catches the back of the group. And the safety car, a quick road car, obviously nothing like the performance of a Formula One car, but he's trying to go quick because they're trying to maintain brake and tyre temperature. And in fact, Jenson Button's been told more brake warming required to get rear temperatures up.
Well, they're running 2 minute 41s right now, and they were running in the 50s in clean air, so significantly slower. And that's why it's difficult for the drivers to maintain tire pressures and brakes, because this is just, you know, this is a window that they never even get into in terms of lap time, even in the wettest of conditions. Safety car will be in this lap, so they've waited long enough. De La Rosa is not going to get the chance to join the back of that group, but everyone else is in line. So look out for the flashing yellow light, and the top of that safety car will be switched off to indicate to the drivers that they can start dropping back from the safety car to get into that final sector. And then it's all down to Sebastian Vettel to control the pace, and he'll need to leave enough of a gap, of course, that when he starts to run for the last corner, 22 and 23, that he's not catching that safety car. He's experienced in this, and what you do when you're running behind these other cars, of course, is you want to be ideally within one car length of the car in front, so you can react at any moment to them going. And yeah, unlikely anyone's going to miss this restart, but some drivers were better at it than others.
Vettel and Button, funnily enough, this was last year much the same. Vettel won this race, and Button was catching him a bit towards the end, but Vettel seemed to have it under control. Button's never won this Grand Prix. Sebastian Vettel did last year. I wonder what's going to happen as we get ready for the restart.
Tyre rotary here. We need to get this next stop spot on.
Jenson Button thought that Vettel was going for it already, and he nearly hit the back of the Red Bull. Now, the Red Bull's there to control the pace, and great cat-like reactions from Button. And I don't think that'll have done any damage to his tyres, and now Vettel's going for it. And it looks like Alonso's missed out a little bit on that getaway. Vettel's going to be clean, I think, as he run down to the first corner. But look at the gap back to Alonso, who, for whatever reason, has been caught out with the restart.
Racing resumes once again in Singapore. Sebastian Vettel has the edge over Jenson Button. Then Fernando Alonso, he maybe got caught out by what Button did. Then you've got Webber attacking Hülkenberg, Perez, Rosberg, then Grosjean. And then up there, Jean-Éric Vergne is ahead of Michael Schumacher. So the pits and stops have certainly worked for Jean-Éric Vergne as they head on around. Maybe there's a chance for him, and Webber still on the attack here, trying to get past the Force India of Hülkenberg. He's on much better tyres. Webber's on the super softy option tyre, and it should be, well, side by side through the kink there. He's not done it yet, and Hülkenberg's busy defending that position on board with Webber. He can't get through just yet, but well, here he comes. He's going to do it now.
It's going to be on the outside, though. It's going to be impossible, I would say, to get round there. And then again, cutting back as they come up to turn 9, and he's gone around eventually. It took him 3 corners to do it, but in the end, Hülkenberg gave way. As we can see, Perez behind has ran wide, and that's allowed Rosberg to get through. And is that Grosjean that's coming up as well?
It is.
So
it's
a
Grosjean.
Mistake from Perez at the restart as they all concertina up through the chicane. This should allow Michael Schumacher an opportunity to have a little run at Jean-Éric Vergne as they go across the Fullerton Bridge, down to the slowest corner on the track.
Not much space on the way in. Perez is on tyres that are older than the others around him, so that's probably partly why he struggled to keep them behind. Here we are side by side as Schumacher does it for the second year in a row. He runs into the back of another car. He hit Perez last year. This time it's Jean-Éric Vergne, and Schumacher again is out of the Singapore Grand Prix. Another non-finish to add to his tally this year. And let's just hope that both drivers are okay, because that was a big impact, David.
It was indeed. Turn 11 last year, turn 14 this year, and it looks like Michael was just caught out by the rate of deceleration of the cars in front. It has to be said, at that moment, these cars are running non-optimal as Michael Schumacher steps out of his car, and it could have been just low front pressures. The car could have grounded, and Michael locks up, and I would expect that he will go to Jean-Éric. And well, racing's racing, and incidents happen. Safety car out.
Yeah, let's just watch that one.
And Michael apologizes to Jean-Éric Vergne. Obviously disappointment for the young Frenchman in his first time here in Singapore.
And he had a chance of points. The way that the pit stops had all worked out there, he was in with a chance of points. Probably wouldn't have scored them, but what a disappointing way to go out of the Grand Prix. The safety car for the second time, and you know what, it's very likely this race will go to the time limit now. We've had two safety car periods, so instead of going to 61 laps, it's likely we're going to go to the 2 hour mark. We've got 38 minutes to go at the moment.
Sure, well, as we get ready for a replay here, we'll have our man with the big brain down in the pit lane do the maths on what the possibilities are. And you see Michael Schumacher here just gets completely caught out by the fact that Perez and Jean-Éric Vergne going side by side into 14. Clearly they break early. And let's see it from another perspective. And as Michael locks up the front axle, and unfortunately the road ahead was just completely blocked. And the only safe thing to do in that point of view is actually hit the car square in the middle to avoid any launching. And
just the way the front's locked so viciously there, coming down the hill. I mean, is that... No, let's listen.
What happened there? What happened there?
Did he get a reply? No. Is there an issue of, you know, they've restarted the race, brake and tyre temperatures are not fully what they were. Is there an issue involved there? Because the way the front locks, that's big time, didn't they?
Yeah, as I was saying, the big difficulty and the big challenge when you're running at lap times considerably slower than you would normally expect is that you struggle to maintain brake temperature, you struggle to maintain tyre temperature, and the car runs lower. And even at turn 14, just slightly over halfway around the lap, and he's only had two or three big braking events, and you could argue that maybe he would have had a chance to fuel the car on the previous corners, but as we see, Red Bull have responded to this. They're in the pit lane,
and
a number of cars are coming in,
and Perez
as well.
Yeah, so those that were a bit out of sequence are using the second safety car to get back out, but of course it will drop them right to the back of the queue, and it's going to make it very difficult to make up places, although they'll have very good tyres for the end of the race. And he's gone out, yes, he had to go on the option tyre there, Hülkenberg, because he hadn't actually used them until this point. So he's on the super soft tyres on the Force India, and Perez as well, because he started on the yellow banded tyre, but Weber is on the soft tyre. And there's a problem, I think there was a problem for the Caterham, wasn't there? Trying to get back out into the race once again.
And it looks like there's been something when the Caterham pit stop. They stopped the car. We're just seeing the back end of it now. Here you can see it on your screen. He was released from his stop and then pulled up. And we're seeing that there'll be an incident involving car 7 and 17. No surprise there. It will be looked at after the race. That's Michael Schumacher and Jean-Éric Vergne.
Second time this year that Michael has run into the back. He did it at Senna in Barcelona as well.
That's right. And he was given a penalty, if we remember, ahead of the Monaco Grand Prix. He took that brilliant pole position and then had to take up another position for the start of the race. Small consolation for Jean-Éric Vergne, or Jev as he's called within the team. He's got the fastest lap of the race so far.
Wow, that's good. It won't last because, of course, they're all burning off fuel and they've got fresh tyres on. But he got fastest lap just presumably that was before the previous safety car period.
Yeah. And I think we've got Pastor Maldonado with Lee McKenzie.
Pastor, you didn't put a foot wrong all weekend, but it just wasn't to be. What did you think when you heard that radio message?
Yeah, very difficult weekend, especially the race. The condition, very hot, the degradation was high, but we were managing quite well, especially the first steam. Even the second one, we've been quite strong on the pace, as I said yesterday. I was expecting to be that competitive during the race, but at the end, we had a hydraulic problem in the car, and that's it. And then we missed the strategy as well to put the super soft compound on the second stop.
But you've been driving so well. It was a cautious start. Was that a deliberately cautious start?
Yeah, the start was okay. But just the first corner, I think cold tires, I ran a bit wide. That was I lost the places there. But after that, I was running quite well. The race pace and rhythm was pretty good, decent. Confident for the next race. We have the pace, we have the potential to be fighting for the victories. And I hope to have better luck next one.
Well driven, no points, bad luck. Thank you.
Just having another look at the Schumacher-Verne incident, and there was some radio from Jenson Button where he was saying, just mention it to Charlie about that restart, because although I know Sebastian Vettel can set the pace, the way that he went and then backed off again, Jenson wasn't very happy about that.
Yeah, well, the stewards will no doubt look at that and make a decision, and I think in many ways Jenson answered his own question that the race leader sets the pace. Once the restart has been announced, you can't, of course, do anything that would be deemed to be unsafe and hinder the cars behind. It was incredibly close.
Yeah.
There's no question about it. Great reactions from Jenson. And a very calm radio message that was being played there to his team.
Just hearing that the problem for Vitaly Petrov from the Caterham was a wheel nut problem, so obviously the wheel wasn't properly attached, and maybe they got on the radio to him, whether he knew or whether they got on the radio. Teams are very quick to stop a car going out on track.
Well, the last thing you need is a problem with your nuts, and that's why the team would have reacted immediately to any doubt once the mechanic had released that car.
So we are still behind safety car, second safety car period of this race. Gary, pretty... must assume that this race is going to go to time, mustn't we, rather than full distance?
Yeah, definitely. It'll be at least two laps short now. I'm just trying to work out the mass with this, without the equipment here. But anyway, yeah, it will go to lap distance for sure. It just depends on how quickly they clear these cars and get it restarted. I mean, it's, as I say, there's a lot of time lost whenever you're trying to let lap cars get past, but we shouldn't have that problem this time.
And Petrov's gone back out, so they were able to redeem the situation. And another good reason for not sending him out. They got the car back, have attached the wheel properly, presumably, and Petrov is still running. I'm amazed at how many are still running. We've lost Maldonado, we've lost Carter Kane, and most notably, of course, we've lost Lewis Hamilton. But and we've lost Verne and Michael Schumacher, of course, in this last incident. There's still 19 cars, and on a track like this, you can expect quite a lot of non-finishes. Safety car is due in this lap, so again, they start to pick up the pace. And Jenson Button there in second, Alonso still a little bit behind in third. Remember, it's Paul Di Resta who's in a fine fourth place here. What an opportunity this is for the young Scot. He's in fourth. Rosberg has come up to fifth place. The race gets underway again. Vettel leads. Button second, then Alonso. Look at the battle behind Raikkonen up the inside of his teammate. Grosjean just manages to shut the door in time. And the two Lotuses are running sixth and seventh. And I was worried for a moment there wouldn't be any Lotuses in the race at all.
Well, always difficult to judge on that closing angle. It looked like a fairly committed Raikkonen down the inside into turn one. And then somehow managing to slow the car down enough on the dirty line before getting close. You see Massa here looking for a way past his fellow Brazilian, Bruno Senna. Massa running in 10th, so he's recovered the situation well, given that he had that puncture on the first lap. And will he have a look on the inside into turn 8? Backs out of it, blocked by Senna, which is absolutely fair enough in those circumstances. Goes down the inside into turn 9.
Oh, and again sideways.
Wow. Senna was wide and Massa was sideways, and I think that was as close as those guys would like to be to an incident in the middle of turn 9.
Felipe's on the softer tyre.
He is, indeed.
He's got a bit more grip here, and he's making the most of it as he attacks Senna. He's going to have another go.
He will have a go as he goes across the bridge, and they touch.
They touch, and Massa slides, and they both get away with it. That's incredible. And
well, brave stuff there from Massa. Got up alongside. I don't think Senna thought for one moment he would try and pass there. and that's why there was the contact, but it doesn't look like there's any serious damage to those cars. And if anyone doubts Massa's commitment, that was real commitment to make a pass there. The only thing he needs is a little bit more speed relative to his teammate to secure his future.
Wow, so Massa and Senna swapping places in an area that is just so narrow and somehow getting away with it. We've got the Kobayashi Sauber just behind. Kovalainen lost a place. I'm not sure where he lost that quite, because he was sitting behind. And then behind Kovalainen, I think we've got Mark Webber sitting in there as well. So some really quick people further down. Let's take another look at this, David, and it is incredibly tight down here.
Well, you would normally not expect anyone to overtake there, and look at Massa drifting the car, more reminiscent of what you see in a MotoGP in the braking phase. So here he comes after turn 10, cuts back through 11 and 12, releases some cares, I'm sure, and then gets squeezed against the wall, but he was committed on the dirty part of the track and somehow stops the car as he gets down into 13. And I just don't think Bruno Senna thought for one moment he was going to be there. And did he touch the Armco on the left-hand side? Well, you'd rather touch Armco. It's a little bit softer than concrete. And great, great control. And, well, Rob Smedley shakes his head in disbelief or amazement. Disbelief, probably, that the door was closed. Amazement that his man was able to hold on to it.
Take a look at this, though. Paul Di Resta hounding the Ferrari of championship leader Fernando Alonso. This is a great effort. The best finish he's had in his Formula One career so far is a sixth place finish. And, well, he's got a good chance of improving on that here. He's chased by Rosberg. And Michael Schumacher now walking back to the paddock area to answer the questions about what happened there. Jean-Éric Vergne trudging back, I would say, after being hit in the rear by the Mercedes of Schumacher.
Well, disappointment for both men, and maybe a tad of embarrassment for Michael, unless there's, as we'll find out in time, unless there was some other issue there. We're expecting and hearing that this race might be about 2 to 3 laps short of full race distance, which will be music to the ears of this man who's leading the Grand Prix. That, of course, just gives him a little bit more safety within the tyre wear of the Red Bull. But it has to be said, on the soft tyre, the prime tyre, it does look like the Red Bull has been a little bit more comfortable on that tyre than the McLaren this afternoon. McLaren looked the more dominant car on the super soft. And as we get into the DRS being re-enabled, crucially, Button is about 1.4 seconds behind Sebastian Vettel, so he won't get the DRS effect as we enter this lap.
Good lap from Button as well. He only lost a couple of hundredths of a second, so they are pretty evenly matched at the moment on this restart. 1-2, and then Alonso in third was a little bit slower. The Ferrari doesn't have the pace of the McLaren and of the Red Bull. Meanwhile, Massa now trying to work his way further up this top 10. He's come up behind Daniel Ricciardo, and Ricciardo running in there in the Toro Rosso. Remember, he's scored points on two occasions this year as Ricciardo. He's got another chance to do so. He'll want to stay in front of Massa, but he could afford to lose the place and still score points, so he won't want to be overly aggressive. Here comes Massa, has a look, but Ricciardo's got that easily covered as they come through the Singapore sling, a little chicane at turn 10, and now we're into the sort of sequence of 90-degree corners down at the bottom end of the circuit.
Well, this is the corner where he was all sideways passing Senna earlier in the race, turn 13. And the Ferrari power on that Toro Rosso seems to be more than a match for the Ferrari power of the Ferrari car behind. And look at Massa cutting the corner there massively.
Yeah.
And he's a man on a mission. This is, you know, more than he would have expected after having that puncture on the first lap. But this is just the way we expect it to be in Singapore. We've had 2 safety cars here. We've had 9 laps of safety car. That's a record. Not the sort of record you want to have on your Grand Prix, but unsurprisingly, the incident involving Massa and Senna will be looked at after the race. In the end, I think that as there was no harm done, it'll probably just pass off as a racing incident and one that we all are very happy to have got away with.
So Ricciardo in 8th place, Massa in 9th, Senna is in 10th place. Kobayashi's just outside the points, he's down in 11th. Then we've got Webber. Vettel is still leading. Kovalainen has just come into the pits again, so that's a little surprising at this stage of the race. But Ricciardo fending off the Ferrari for the moment, but we're into DRS territory here And this is where the Ferrari's got a big opportunity. They're using KERS as well, the electrical energy boost that is recharged each lap.
We see that Ricciardo used all of his DRS to defend. And this Ferrari, it's like what kerbs? It just drives over the top of the kerbs. And he's got such confidence there as he comes to the outside, like he did with Senna before turn nine, cuts back to the inside. Neither of them have, well, Massa had a little bit of kerbs available, which has enabled them to get past the Toro Rosso as they come down to turn 10. So good, good strategic driving there from Felipe Massa, and that brings him now up into eighth place.
Yeah, so that matches his best ever finish here in Singapore, and there's a bit of time still to go in this race. And Senna now trying to target that Toro Rosso as well. Let's see if he can get past and behind Kobayashi.
They're investigating the incident with Massa, so they saw that.
Well, that sounds to me like the engineer at Williams thinks that it may have been marginal from Massa's side. I don't see why you would want to tell your racing driver, who, in my opinion, is probably the one under question. You know, it was questionable whether Bruno had maybe squashed a little bit Massa towards the wall. You know, I would see it more like a racing incident, one that was we were lucky to see the drivers get away with, rather than it being a sort of clear penalty to be applied.
Now, Jenson Button has just set fastest lap. Gary, that's looking quite impressive from the McLaren, which is currently running in second place. Let's just watch Senna just up towards the top corner for a moment here, see if he's going to have any more of a go at getting past Daniel Ricciardo as they come towards the DRS zone. I'll come back to you in a second, Gary, on that, because actually both Vettel and Button lapping very quickly at the moment into DRS territory here. And we're going to switch away from that and take a look at how Massa got past Ricciardo.
He was on the outside of nine and then was able to cut back to the inside on the run down to turn 10. And crucially, he had a little bit of curves left over. And round of applause from the team.
So, Gary,
good lad. That's P8. P8 now.
Yeah, they're very pleased with that. Gary, it's been a cat and mouse up front, isn't it, between Vettel and Button?
Yeah, there's a bit of cat and mouse. You know, they've got the fuel now. They've got the fresh tyres on during that safety car. So these two guys are out for the race win. You know, Vettel did do the fastest lap at 53.1. Then Jensen did a 53.0. There's 1.8 seconds gap between them. So it's, what is it? There's 14 laps to go. But that'll get cut back to about 10 or 11 because of the time thing. So if Jensen's going to do something, he has to get on with it now. That was close.
It was close, wasn't it? Hülkenberg battling away with Perez here at the back of the queue. Meanwhile, Webber is trying to move up on Kobayashi in the Sauber. They're all just outside the top 10. And Kobayashi's on tyres that have done 16 laps. And they're the softer tyre as well. So he will be struggling for grip now. Softer tyres as well for the guys at the back of that queue, because they went on a different strategy from early on in this race. And so Mark Webber, desperate to try and get past the Sauber quickly, because those two behind him may be a major threat. Now, what are we looking at here? Kimi Raikkonen behind Grosjean.
Kimi is quicker, do not hold him up.
Team order there, Kimi is quicker, do not hold him up. And then Grosjean responds to that immediately. Well, we presume it's immediately. We don't know when that radio message was played in.
No, but it's important, isn't it? I mean, Kimi Raikkonen coming into this race third in the championship. He will, Vettel will move up to second in the championship, but with Hamilton failing to score, every point counts. It's important to get Raikkonen ahead of Grosjean.
Grosjean has shown maybe slightly better pace than Kimi during the course of this race weekend, but that's a clear team decision based on, as Mark
Webber comes Webber, yeah.
Faints, Kobayashi reacts to Mark Webber, suggesting he was going to have a go down the inside, and in the end manages to hold it as they run out of turn 7. But Mark not quite close enough to Kobayashi to do anything. He's got Hülkenberg behind on the super softs. Yeah. Give him a little bit more performance at this stage. But Mark's got to get closer to Kobayashi to be able to effect to pass.
So Vettel still leads this race with Button in second, still a gap about 1.5 seconds as Perez tucks right under the rear wing again of the Force India. A little bit of brake locking going on. Perez showing a nose around the outside, never a chance to go around the outside there though, unless something really goes wrong up towards turn 14. But again, all following each other, and at the front of this little queue at the moment, Kamui Kobayashi. trying not to make any mistakes on tyres that have got less grip than the guys around him. Vettel and Button, still no change up front. Alonso, the world championship leader, still in third place. Paul de Resta is in fourth. Rosberg is in a good fifth position. And now we've got Raikkonen up into sixth place, having got past Romain Grosjean. Seventh place for Grosjean. Massa is in eighth. Then Ricciardo, then Senna, and then this lot. All fighting for 11th place, as you can see. And you're riding on board with Sergio Perez as he comes out of the final turn.
Well, this stage of the Grand Prix, cars getting light and racy. It starts to feel a bit more like you had during qualifying. There's a lot of rubber on the racing line, which improves the overall grip available to the drivers. But they've been sitting in those cars now for about an hour and 44 minutes. And they will, although they've had the little break behind the safety car, the heat, the constant draining heat, will affect their ability to make good decisions. And they will probably have lost a couple of kilos of body weight, which is a couple of liters of fluid. And at that point, your decision-making abilities start to drop off.
Okay, Jensen, 12 more laps to go. 12 more laps. This is a straight fight with Vettel.
It is a straight fight. No pit stops. It is just to the flag. And it's like this last year, because same situation occurred then. Senna just gone through the shot, and he's in 10th place. So the Williams, the only one remaining Williams.
So, Mark, we will hit the two-hour limit. This is a 60-lap race at the moment, 60.
Well, they reckon that we'll only be one lap short.
Oh, and
down
he goes
the inside!
For it.
And can he get past
contact,
Perez?
And his front wing.
And it takes the front wing off of Perez's car. And there is contact in the end between the two of them. And this is where it's going to count, because he won't slow down very well.
Well, brave stuff. Locked up wheel, almost touching the back of the Force India, and he takes his hand from the wheel. So he's damaged the front wing. The winglets are gone. He'll assess through these next few corners whether that's going to be something that he can hang in and make it to the end of this race. A pit stop at this stage, of course, is going to drop him well out of any potential battle for points this afternoon. And he was shaping up for that pass for the last few laps. Hülkenberg had been going defensive, and in the end, Perez took a dive, and, well, contact was made. He's still out there.
He hasn't come in, so he feels as though the damage isn't too bad. Let's take another look. The last car of the queue here is Perez.
Well, the door was open, and he cuts well to the inside. And, well, how would you call that?
He had to use a lot of the inner part of the track, didn't he? To try and make the move.
The question is, did Hülkenberg know he was there?
Yeah.
And if he did, then you just can't turn in once the car's there. But likewise,
Weber's got the chance to get past Kobayashi, and he's done it this time. Surely
has
no.
It?
Kobayashi fights him off. Weber trying to go around the outside. He's on the curb. He was all four wheels over. Now, will that be classified?
And Hülkenberg follows him through.
He does. Kobayashi really
strong. And he's lost his front wing.
Two Sauber front wings damaged in one lap. And Perez goes past his teammate. And Hülkenberg's in trouble. He's got a puncture. Hülkenberg's got a puncture. And this huge battle that's been going on has all been split up in the end, sadly, by contact. So Kobayashi limping, Hülkenberg limping as well. And opportunity for them to score points. They were just outside the points, remember. It was a fierce encounter, but sadly, we're going to lose at least a couple of them. Could be some bits of debris around, of course, for leaders coming around in a moment.
Well, unquestionably will. So here you have Kobayashi. But you see, he was pretty fair there with Mark. He could have ran him wide over the curb. And great pass from Mark. Kobayashi forced to leave the door open. That allows space for Hülkenberg. And I'm not quite sure whether why the contact happened there, because it didn't look to me like Hülkenberg was trying to squeeze Kobayashi down. And again, as I said earlier, they can't actually see the sides of the wheels, never mind where the front wing is, as Peter Sauber, well, speaks Swiss-German, and I'm not a lip reader.
Oh,
and then we
Senna.
See Senna touches the tech rule. Looks like he gets away with it, but was there damage to the car before he went there? And let's just see where Senna's running. He was up to 10th.
He is still behind Ricciardo. He hasn't dropped a position. Weber is catching him, though. So that's what he's got to be wary of. There is Romain Grosjean, chased by Felipe Massa. Massa is still going quickly here, so there's a chance for the Ferrari to gain another place. Up front, though, Vettel is flying, as we say. He's just done that 1 minute 52.1. He's opened the gap to Button now to 2.5 seconds. And Vettel, looking very comfortable, is in for a nose cone change. comes the Sauber of Kamui Kobayashi, and that's a shame for it to end that way. And it, as you say, it just seemed a little unnecessary, the two tangling. They've both paid the price, though, because Hülkenberg's ended up with a puncture.
Yeah, I think we need to look a little bit more closely at that to try and work out whether it's just a racing incident or... As Hülkenberg, well, he struggled to get the, I think the car went into an anti-stall there. He re-engages the clutch and it resets the system, but he's well out of a point-scoring position this afternoon.
Rosberg still holding on to fifth place. We lost the other Mercedes, of course, and we're going to see an investigation into the Massa Senna action. Oh, in fact, no further action, so that one's sorted.
Yeah, I think that's yep. the right thing. Yep. You know, there was no debris or damage to the cars. And they just about left each other enough room.
Yeah, just about got away with it. Alan McNish is the driver steward this weekend. He's having quite a busy time of it, isn't he? So
he
on
is.
Board with Perez. He's still got that damage to the front wing, but he's continuing.
Front wing looks okay, Checo. Front wing looks okay.
Well, that will be the engineer's look at the load sensors, the data that's fed back to the pits. And, well, I would expect that would lose a little bit of front load. Otherwise, you question why they have those winglets on there if they're not doing something. But it's clearly not upsetting the balance enough to bring that car in this afternoon.
Look at the lap comparisons button. It's just dropping away a little bit on the last few laps from Sebastian Vettel, who seems to be controlling the pace of this race. We've got just under a quarter of an hour still to go in this race. We're not quite going to get the full distance in the 2 hours. Alonso is still in a rather, well, I say lonely third. Di Resta's under 2 seconds behind Alonso. So Di Resta's still heading for a great result here today. And it'll boost Force India's chances as well, keeping that gap to Williams in the Constructors' Championship. Rosberg fifth, Raikkonen in sixth. More investigating to do, though. This time it'll be the incident between Webber and Kobayashi.
Well, the question there, I suppose, will be, did Mark Webber gain the place by running wider than the track limits on the exit of turn 7? Well, to my mind, he was on the top of the kerb, so one side of his car clearly within the white lines. Send me a tweet if you think that my old eyes are failing me, but that's how I would read that one. Let's see what the race stewards decide. Then Alonso, meanwhile, has set the fastest middle sector of the Grand Prix so far. 43.6, couple of tenths quicker than our race leader Button, and that's him just responding.
Race
to
leader
the
Vettel.
Excuse me?
Race leader
race
Vettel.
Leader Vettel. What yeah. did I say, Ben?
Button,
excuse me.
You gave Button the race lead there. That would have given
a... I'm feeling the fatigue of this race.
It's a long race.
It is a long race, but anyway, that's Alonso responding to the pressure that Di Resta was putting on him.
Yeah, good lap there by Alonso. Quicker than Button, but not quite as quick as Vettel. But as you say, definitely responding to Di Resta's pace. Rosberg behind in fifth position. I wonder whether Rosberg might come under some threat from Kimi Raikkonen. The gap 1.8 seconds between Rosberg and Raikkonen. And the Mercedes can be a bit harder on its tyres. We've seen that in the closing stages of some races. And they both put their current tyres on the same lap, lap 32, interestingly enough.
Well, as we go and see our race leader tracked down there by Jenson Button through turn 10, it does look at this stage, as we were saying earlier, as if the McLaren just not quite as comfortable on this soft tyre, the prime tyre that's available this afternoon. And it's such a, you know, yo-yo of performance between these cars. You know, full of fuel, they work well on one tyre. As the fuel burns off, it doesn't work quite so well. And that's what makes the strategy in 2012 so difficult to read for the teams. And, of course, what chance do we have standing up here in our air-conditioned BBC suite, as I referred to it earlier. It's this very small box overlooking the last corner here in Singapore. Spectacular view nonetheless.
Look at the championship prediction. Vettel would move up into second place in the championship, and the gap would reduce a little bit, but Alonso still doing well. Raikkonen would be in a clear third. He would be in third place, wouldn't he? Kimi Raikkonen. And of course, Hamilton will be pushed back down with not scoring here at all. So it is interesting, but Alonso always manages to get there. He's up on the podium. Now, we saw Michael Schumacher crash into the back of Jean-Éric Vergne a little earlier in this race. Lee is now talking to him.
Michael, a different year, a similar accident. Tell us what happened.
I mean, first of all, after safety car and I braked a little bit earlier than I would normally do in this corner, but car wouldn't decelerate, so I need to investigate why that is the case. And at one point I understood I couldn't decelerate, and then I just went straight on the brakes, very hard, locked up everything, but tried to brake as much as it was somehow possible, but the accident at that moment wasn't avoidable anymore. Obviously I feel sorry for Jean-Eric that he had to retire for this one, and for the guys and for the team, but we need to find out what happened.
Well, we did wonder, we did suspect there might have been a problem, and certainly Michael Schumacher relaying that there was an issue with the car, the way it locked up and seemed to lose no real pace at all before he ran into the back of Verne. Meanwhile, the other Toro Rosso is still in the points, by the way. Ricciardo is still ninth. We're all on board with Mark Webber, though, here. And Webber is behind Senna and trying to chase down the last point, 10th place. And we know that Senna certainly just brushed the wall earlier on, didn't he? That's going to... a bit of a clip over the curve there as well. Mark Gillam, the technical boss there at Williams, keeping an eye on things. We lost Maldonado in this race earlier when it looked as though Maldonado was heading for a good haul of points here today. Driven superbly, but they had a hydraulic problem that put them out of the race, sadly. We've seen Schumacher go out, hitting Verne. We've seen Carter Kane hit the wall. And we saw Hamilton pull off with a gearbox problem. But right now, Sebastian Vettel leads this race.
Well, a couple of things we've been hearing. Force India have told Paul de Resta that Alonso's tyres are 4 laps older. So that's to give him a little bit of confidence that he's got 20 kilometres less on his tyres and he can apply a bit of pressure. They can see a podium, and much as they would love the points for fourth place, it would improve on his sixth place finish here last year. It would be a big result if they could get a car up onto that podium. We're also being told that Sebastian Vettel has had a message from his engineer asking him to move the brake balance forward because he's losing front temperature in his tyres. And that just shows the sort of level of interaction between the pit wall and the drivers as they constantly manage this car.
You have 1 lap of Kerr's overtake when you need it.
So Mark being given a little bit of information as he tries to get past Bruno Senna.
Well, that'll be all to do with the battery temperatures, and they're telling him he's got 1 lap available where he can use his Kerr's as a full overtaking device. And here he goes. He's got DRS, he's got momentum as they run down to turn 7, and in the end doesn't have to run it as bravely round the outside in 7. He manages that pass, and that's for that last point available this afternoon. Just over 7.5 minutes of racing time available before it'll be the last lap, so it's not over yet. And so here we see a replay here. Yeah, and I'll just pick it up, comes out of the slipstream. Bruno decides to go defensive as they come through the kink at 6, and from Mark's position he just catches them at the kink. Bruno's already made his move, shown his hand, and then Mark pulls it around the outside. So here's a replay from the other side as well. Well, we're getting 4 replays of the same event. I think it's probably just because of the sparking from the underside of the Williams as they come over the crest of the public road the rest of the year.
So the clock ticking away in the top of the screen now, so we are in a timed race. It's a 2-hour maximum limit on any Grand Prix while it's running. If it gets red flagged and stopped, there's a new rule this year that the whole duration can't be more than 4 hours, even including a stopped race. But if the race is running, it goes to a maximum of 2 hours. In fact, interestingly, it's been a long, long time since a dry race went to the full 2-hour limit. Back in 1991, the Phoenix Grand Prix, another street track. And of course, average speed on a street track is low. They try and get a certain distance, around 300 kilometres of Grand Prix in. But, we've just reached the limit this time because we've had a couple of safety cars.
Do you remember who won the 1991 Phoenix Grand Prix?
That was a Senna win, wasn't it?
It was the one
that Jean Alesi had a massive go in the Tyrrell. Brilliant, brilliant race that
Classic
was.
Classic Grand Prix.
Yeah, really great. Now, we're watching Daniel Ricciardo, and he's in the points. He's in ninth place currently. He's still got the Red Bull, though, of Mark Webber chasing him. And Senna has now dropped out of the points. He's down to 11th place. So here we've got Ricciardo. He could afford to give up that place and still get a point, but he won't want to give up the place. Might be the sister team, but they run totally, totally separately, of course. Toro Rosso based in Italy. Let's listen to Senna's radio.
Try to keep as close to Webber as possible. Try and hold position now. Anything can still happen. Not long to go.
And Tom McCulloch there just giving a bit of encouragement to Bruno Senna. Has had a difficult weekend. A point would have been so much better for Senna if he could have got something. And Williams look like they're going to get nothing out of this, David, after having a car on the front row of the grid.
Yeah, that's... Well, I was going to say it's disappointing. That's an understatement. All of these teams work incredibly hard. Doesn't matter if it's HRT at running around at the back more often than not, or the teams at the front. And it's a relentless slog of development and travel, but that's what makes this the Grand Prix. And this is one of the hardest of them all. Even with the two safety cars we had here this afternoon, the drivers will have lost a lot of fluid, and just a 2% loss of fluid can affect your ability to actually compute and make decisions by up to 20%, believe it or not. So you start thinking, well, shall I brake now? No, should I brake there? Should I brake here?
Yeah, start
to
very confused.
Play tricks with your mind, as we see the normal shaking foot there of Christian Horner. We don't know, of course, whether they're nursing any issues or whether it's a straightforward drive to the end of this Grand Prix. We have to presume that Lewis Hamilton was masking some sort of gearbox issue from yesterday, from the radio message we heard his engineer play when he retired the car. And Mark Webber here chasing down the Toro Rosso, running out of time, just over 4 minutes of race time left before the final lap. It does look like he does have the pace to get by this Toro Rosso, but they tend to set that car up with good straight line speed. But of course, if he just burned out his tires, Mark Webber has a kick of oversteer out of turn nine. See what I mean? The Toro Rosso opens the gap slightly as they run along the straight, so that makes it difficult to find the right place to have a go. And they were saying the incident involving Mark Webber and Kobayashi will be looked at after the race, because the stewards are, frankly, we're just too busy right now to make a decision on that. We'll get back to you. Hopefully they won't take too long.
Meanwhile, Vettel still controlling this race. He's got a 6.1 second advantage now over Jensen Button. There you are, riding on board with Sebastian Vettel, and the team are happy with what's going on. The flashing little LEDs on the crash helmet doing a merry dance, much as Sebastian Vettel has had since Hamilton retired. This race could well have been a massive confrontation between Hamilton and Vettel, but the way it has turned out, Vettel has actually been comfortable in the closing stages, and although Button challenged for a while, he's now dropped to 6.7 seconds behind. Webber, though, has not given up on trying to take ninth place away from Daniel Ricciardo. Two Australians racing hard here, one very established in Formula One, another one trying to make his mark.
Well, Aussie honour at stake here, and this would be a big result for Daniel Ricciardo. The Toro Rosso team will, I doubt very much, be thinking about who owns the team at this stage of the race. Just want to come back to Sebastian Vettel's flashing lights. Apparently, they represent the star signs of his family. Now, I noticed it was a half moon as I came to the commentary box, Ben. Now, I don't know if that means anything, the star signs of his family, a half moon, as everything aligned this afternoon to give him his second victory this afternoon. Certainly looks like it, with just over 2 minutes left on the clock.
Yeah, it's looking good for Vettel, but Mark Webber still can't, even in that DRS zone, he's not really able to close the gap to Daniel Ricciardo, who's driving beautifully well here. He's defending resolutely, not making any mistakes so far. When the clock ticks to zero, then the checkered flag comes out at the end of that lap. So whichever lap the clock goes to zero on, you'll see the checkered come out at the end of that lap. And Webber is therefore running out of time, because he's got a minute and a half to go.
Copy, loss of power, loss of power. We'll look at the data.
It's not getting any better for Williams, is it? His last lap time was some 6 seconds slower than those around him, a loss of power. Meanwhile, Sebastian Vettel, and he's up at the top part of the corner. The clock will tick to zero, I think, on this lap. So this will probably be the final lap of the race for Sebastian Vettel. And it's amazing to think, double world champion as he is, and that dominant season last year, David, this will only be his second victory of 2012, if all goes to plan here.
Yeah, well, let's not speak too soon, but I think it just shows how competitive this season has been. We've got Alonso and three victories. Hamilton, of course, as Bruno Senna retires the car. He was running in 12th place, and that loss of power looks terminal. And, this victory will bring Sebastian Vettel up alongside Mark Webber and Jenson Button on two victories apiece. So still one away from our championship leader and Lewis Hamilton. What could have been for him this afternoon, but that's racing. You could have said the same for Sebastian Vettel in Valencia. He was running away with the race there when he had mechanical troubles.
Well, Adrian Newey was a race winner himself last weekend at Goodwood, but it looks as though he's led that team once again to yet another victory in Formula One. Just got to deal with a little bit of traffic and nervous moment perhaps for Vettel, but all under control. The clock is ticking down and the checkered flag will be prepared at the end of this lap. His gap over Jenson Button has been built up to 8.3 seconds. And with the loss of Lewis Hamilton from this race with a gearbox problem, really from that moment on, it's all been straightforward for Sebastian Vettel. He was able to manage his tyres. He was able to manage the restarts. We've seen how accomplished this young man is. And he's going to do it yet again. He comes through the final two corners in Singapore to take back-to-back victories in Singapore for Sebastian Vettel, his second win of the season. What a time to do it as he tries to close the gap to Alonso in the championship. Jenson Button finishes in second position and looks back at that non-finish in Monza now, and that must hurt even more. But Alonso once again picks up a podium finish, his 81st podium finish for Fernando Alonso. He's still racking up the points. But here, Sebastian Vettel has taken the fourth Red Bull win of the year. Two each now, Mark Webber and Sebastian Vettel.
Well, great victory, no question about it. And again, we see the flashing lights there. Couldn't help but think, I wonder how much extra reserve they've got in the battery for those little flashers. But Sebastian Vettel waves to the crowd, enjoys a cooling lap. I think they're in laps here. They'll have plenty of fuel, of course, on board, given the safety cars, and the fireworks explode above the bay here. Fantastic scenes celebrating the fifth running of the Singapore Grand Prix.
Beautiful, yeah, just it always looks so stunning, this place at night time. And once again, it's delivered an entertaining race. Sebastian Vettel won here last year, and now he's won again.
You beauty, sir. Well done. You've won the Singapore Grand Prix again. You're back in this championship, well done.
Good man, top job.
Great reaction. And you know what, in 2010, not last year, but in 2010, when we had that wonderful battle for the championship, he was 31 points off the lead of the title race in Singapore, and he went on to win. And there were fewer races left on the calendar. He was 39 off the lead coming in this time. There is no reason why Vettel can't do what he did in 2010 and take it all the way to the wire and keep that pressure on. Alonso will know that. He got a third place finish today. Hamilton, well, he's not out of it, but it's going to hurt hugely, having suffered the loss of 25 points. I mean, I'm assuming he would have won. He may not have done, but he would have at least, I think, been on the podium.
Well, Formula One is a roller coaster. Your emotions are taken from the highest of highs to the lowest of lows, no matter who you are. And I often say that even if you're the most successful driver in this sport, and that currently is Michael Schumacher in terms of race victories, he's still lost more than he's won. So you have to deal with the disappointment which inevitably comes. That's obviously not a record you'd want if you were a boxer, but it's part of Grand Prix racing.
So 23rd career victory for Sebastian Vettel, and that matches Nelson Piquet Senior now. So Nelson Piquet, a winner also of some 23 Grand Prix, and Sebastian Vettel doing it at such an important time. There's been 9 Grand Prix have taken place this year since his last win. But just look at that, the fireworks over Singapore. Fireworks today for Sebastian Vettel, although he stayed out of trouble. He looked after the car, he looked after the tyres. Disappointed yesterday with his qualifying, only managed third on the grid. Made a good getaway, of course, that certainly helped him. He was Lewis Hamilton's closest pursuer in those early stages. And that's lovely, a lovely touch from Sebastian Vettel, remembering Sid Watkins. Professor Sid Watkins, who sadly died last week, the prof, the doctor of Formula One. We had the 1 minute silence on the grid leading into the race in memory of Sid, and that's lovely that Sebastian recognised him on the slowdown lap and on his victory here in Singapore. He is a class act, this young guy. I mean, it's easy to forget that he's only 25 years old, but he just thinks about everything.
Well, I think that's the key element there. He's not just a fast racing driver. We've seen many of those over the years. But he is very respectful of the history of this sport. And to take time out there to recognise a much-loved figure in the sport, as he then stands and shows that famous finger. Fans of Sebastian will love to see it. Those who would rather have seen another winner will probably look away at that point, but there's no question that he was on his way for a podium, irrespective of the issue that Lewis Hamilton had. And he strokes his car, probably pretty hot, that engine cover, after 2 hours of Grand Prix racing.
I think this car's still Abby. He named it was Abby earlier this year. I think it's still Abby. He likes to name his cars, doesn't he?
Yes, he does.
Yeah. Sorry, I threw you completely there, didn't I? Yeah. But there you are. There's the famous indicator of yet another victory for Sebastian Vettel. His 41st podium finish. Alonso, though, now going ahead of Ayrton Senna in terms of podium finishes. He matched it last time out, of course. But Alonso now goes one ahead of the late great Ayrton Senna. And Alonso very much talking about that third title being his big objective. That's what Senna achieved. That's very much what Alonso wants to achieve. But let's not forget that Button got that second place here today. Solid drive by Jenson Button. Very valuable points for McLaren. And in terms of the Constructors' Championship, of course, Red Bull just outscore... Well, no, they wouldn't have... Yeah, they would have outscored McLaren, but McLaren won't have lost too much ground because Webber only picked up the 1 point for 10th place. Just watching Sebastian Vettel's celebrations across the line. And in other championship terms, Kimi Raikkonen did finish in 6th place, so he scored points, not as many as Lotus would have liked to try and keep him in that championship hunt, but nonetheless useful points. And let's not forget that Paul de Resta has had his best ever finish in Formula 1. So Paul de Resta finished in 4th place. He got his best finish here in Singapore last year, 6th. He matched that earlier on this year in Bahrain. But Paul de Resta has earned his best ever finish in Formula 1. Many congratulations.
And Force India will exceed their 2011 points total. And that matches the 4th place that Nico Hülkenberg had a couple of races ago in Spa. Great drive there from Paul. Good time to be showing that you are a potential team leader.
With the driver market still very undecided for next year.
And that's a hug there. That's Ollie Chang.
I almost worked you out as well. Yeah, that's a good start.
Yeah, well, you were 2 hours waiting in the garage. At least we had something to do.
We got a big fan in front of us.
It's long, huh? It goes on forever. I looked at the screen 28 laps ago. Yeah.
It's now on time. Yeah. Not laps anymore.
Oh, was it just one lap less? Or?
Two laps less.
Two laps.
Very interesting how Alonso not engaging at all in the conversation there.
Well, I suspect it's because a couple of years ago, well, go back to 2008, after that race, Fernando actually suggested to the drivers that we shorten this race by some distance. He felt it was just a bit too long, a bit too uncomfortable. So I think he's probably just reflecting on whatever discomfort he's got in his body. It is hard. You know, he was training between Monza and here, doing over 100 miles of running, several hundred miles of running. And as you see, the helmet there of Sebastian Vettel. And I think his number two mechanic, Olli Schack, is going up there, recently lost his father. He is a Danish mechanic, and obviously the team want to recognize his contribution and give him his moment of glory.
So the drivers heading out onto the podium now. Sebastian Vettel, Jenson Button, and Fernando Alonso. The victory leap for Sebastian Vettel, and time for the anthems. to Sebastian Vettel. Red Bull seem to be back on track as Sebastian Vettel takes victory here in Singapore. That victory in Bahrain, the last one, seems a while ago, but he's done it here under the floodlights in Singapore, a track he loves clearly. He raced to the victory here 12 months ago. He chased Alonso across the line for the closest ever finish here in 2010. And clearly it's one that is a real favourite. The Constructors' Trophy going to Red Bull as well. Mark Webber, of course, brought the other car home in 10th. Disappointing, really, but they were on a different strategy with that car. And Jenson Button now collecting the trophy for second place. And he and Hamilton, almost the same number of podiums. That's his 48th podium now, I think, for Jenson Button. Very similar. His dad there, his partner as well. Fernando Alonso, though, again scoring consistently, as he has been doing all season long, in his 190th Grand Prix. He takes his 81st podium, and Ferrari are still picking up the points. And to come onto the podium this time to ask the questions of the man who's going to do it in just a second, the champagne first, of course. Time to celebrate the victory. But it is going to be a very special interviewer today. It's going to be none other than our very own Eddie Jordan, who's going to be coming up and asking the questions of these guys. I don't know how much energy they've got left after that grueling two-hour race in these very, very tricky conditions. Certainly enjoying a bit of cooling champagne over their heads. But in this new format of interviews that is being done in Formula One now, and the guest interviewers that come along and talk to the drivers, it is going to be Eddie Jordan who will be making his first appearance on the podium, really, since his team won four Grand Prix in the late 1990s and early 2000s, of course. So I wonder what the guys are going to be able to say to him. Big, big round of applause, though, for all of the three of these drivers. I should think all they probably want to do is to get back downstairs and get some fluids on board and try and relax a little bit, because this has been one very, very tough race.
The drivers on the podium, the legendary former Formula One team owner and now TV broadcaster, Eddie Jordan.
Welcome, everybody. And the winners here, I think we should start with Sebastian. Sebastian, first ever back-to-back winner here. Tell us, what's the secret?
Got my own.
Oh. BBC well, don't have their own, but anyway, please go ahead.
Thank you very much. I think it's one of the toughest races all year, to be honest. It's very long. We did the full 2 hours. The circuit is a killer. There's so many bumps. There's no space for mistakes, and the race just seems to go on forever. And obviously, we benefit a little bit from Lewis's failure, which I could see a couple of laps before that he lost oil. And obviously after that, I think generally we had a very, very strong pace all weekend. And a good start, which got us into second and in the hunt. The pace was there, so I'm just incredibly happy and proud, because this is such a tough race, so proud to win it. And I would like to dedicate it to one very, very special man, Mr. Sid Watkins, who passed away. And he will be remembered for sure. I think he's...
Well done.
One of the biggest reasons that we can go out on a circuit like this, enjoy ourselves and be reasonably safe, because he pushed... the boundaries in terms of safety for all of us. So a big thank you.
And, here, here. We support those sentiments enormously. But I just have to ask you, can you see something reminiscent to the fact of 2010, how you came from this position to just sneak that win and the championship in 2010?
Yeah, I think Fernando wouldn't be too happy if that happens again in the last race.
I'll ask him something in the end, don't worry.
But no, I think it's an incredible season for all of us, approaching the weekend not knowing what's going to happen. Everything can happen in the race, so it's a lot of fun for us, for the people to watch, but I think we have a lot of races left. The car seems to be competitive, and we just got to use the momentum and keep pushing in the next couple of races to make sure we finish ahead of those guys.
Thank you. Jenson, I've got to ask you, what did happen on the restart?
Sorry, Eddie?
What happened on the restart? You were complaining on the radio. We could hear you in case you couldn't hear yourself. Can you ask him?
First of all, good evening, everyone. Was that fun? Good. I'm glad. It was pretty tough 2 hours for us. But, the restart, Sebastian accelerated and braked for the right-hander. And I just didn't expect that, you know, such a speed difference. So I hit the brakes, locked up, and just missed the rear of his car, which would have been quite embarrassing. But we got through it, and yeah, it's a good second place. I'm reasonably happy with that. You know, we all want to win, but you can't win them all.
Does that second place, does it make up in some small way for Monza?
Yeah, it does. But, you know, it's for us as a team to have another failure here this weekend is disappointing. But the important thing for us is we have a very good car. I think the team are doing a fantastic job. And it seems that every race we go to, we really do have a chance of winning. So that's important to us.
Thank you for that. And Fernando Alonso! Our championship leader, Fernando. You also have won twice here, and now on the podium again, must be one of your favorite tracks.
Yeah, good evening, everybody. Of course, it's one of the best tracks to drive, to enjoy the weekend in general. It's out of our normal routine, let's say, of times, etc. So we enjoy driving here. The atmosphere is fantastic. The layout is quite interesting, and it was a fun race again.
You still have 29-point lead in the championship, but yet you haven't won since Germany. Are all your opponents, are they all falling away or tripping over themselves?
Well, in Monza it was Luis winning the race and Sebastian retired. Here is Sebastian retired, Luis, Sebastian winning, Luis retiring. So for me it's okay if they keep doing like this.
Ladies and gentlemen, to everybody out there throughout the world watching this unbelievable show here from Singapore, thank you very much.